Awesome. Okay, so we're going to get started. So what we're doing today, let me just clarify what we're doing. We had over 100 people registered for today's session. And this is the sixth session in a, six-session series that's called the Bigger Than Me Success Series. It's designed to achieve racial equity and inclusion in business, education, wealth, and health. We've been having some amazing conversations around how do you truly change systems? First, acknowledging that there is a problem, but then also acknowledging that there are really clear solutions. There are things that we can do. And what's super exciting is this isn't about one of us having a conversation. This is called the Bigger Than Me Success Series because it's actually bigger than me. It's bigger than you as an individual, but together we know this is not bigger than us. And today our focus for this session, and again, it's not about the session because all of this content is coming together to produce a video documentary. There's going to be a full series of videos that will be produced so that everyone in corporate America, everyone in any business, any academic institution will be able to go on this journey with us. We have actually cracked the nut. It's almost like solving the cure for polio. This isn't that difficult, right? You just got to have the right people who are willing to have the right conversations. And so this is called What Success Looks Like because each of you represents success to me. You each represent a component of success. So when I call on you, as we go through this conversation, that we're scheduled for 2 hours today. And then we also have a bonus session that we're going to continue afterwards, because this is about the recording. It's less about this particular moment. Although in this moment, our goal is to really touch hearts and minds. But that's what this bigger initiative is going to do. The book that's being created. So just by you telling your stories today, you're actually changing the world. That's what we're doing. And I have slides that I could show, but I'm not, because I have more live voices. I have videos that I could show, but I'm not. Because again, I'd rather bring your live voices in. One of the videos that I show often is a TED Talk. And it's basically, you know, how to create a movement. So that's a video that we're going to show, insert as a part of the video later. I also share two videos from Brené Brown. One of them, she talks about basically telling our stories. Stories that we own, we get to write the ending. And stories that we don't own, own us. And so we have a diverse group of people here today who are owning our stories. Thank you very much. We are supposed to be doing a Facebook Live as well. Thank you, Jonni. Hopefully that's working. Thank you for that, Jonni. It's preparing a live stream. Again. This is all about changing the status quo. So we're going to go back to the faces and the individuals that are here today that are truly changing the status quo. I'm going to start with introductions and we're going to go to our beautiful gallery view. And I'm going to start with Mr. Bill Wells. And Bill has been a part of this since the very beginning. Each of you are now part of the book. You're each part of the video series. It's official. But Bill, I actually lost Bill in my view. I did. So I'm actually going to go to Rex. Rex, you have been a part of this initiative from the beginning. Can you do a quick introduction? Tell us who you are and why is this work so important?
Hi, Tracy. Good to be with you all. My name is Rex Brown. I'm the Program Director for Business Diversity at Governor Inslee's State of Washington. And I think that for me, what I have been passionate about and doing for most of my career is creating transformative and innovative programs in equity, diversity, and inclusion to move forward past generational divides. In order to do that, and I think a really important component of what we're going to talk about, and it's bigger than me today, is perhaps the idea of, or the dual idea of accountability and forgiveness. Sometimes we often say that accountability is crucial in the work that we do, and it is. But so is forgiveness, especially in places where people have decided to forgive themselves despite the impacts that they have had on the lives of others. And that's a new complexity in the work that we do today, not because it's anything new, but it requires a new emphasis. Thank you, Tracy. And again, it's good to be with you all here. It's bigger than me.
I love that. Miss Cassandra Mitchell, you're another person who's been a part of this since the very beginning. You're like my, you guys are literally, I feel like the luckiest woman in the world to be around and to be connected with each of you because you're so amazing. Cassandra, tell us who you are and tell us why corporate responsibility is so important and why individual accountability is so important.
Thank you, and good morning and afternoon to everyone. It's been an honor to be a part of these conversations, Tracy, and I really believe whether it's corporate responsibility, giving back to the community, engaging the community, we're all part of the community. So it starts with each one of us, right? That self-awareness, deep introspection of ourselves, how we contribute into the society, into our organization, and all of that, right? Your beliefs, your values, how you show up, how you're seen, is all part of this inclusion and the importance of equity and racial justice, right? We can't change, if we can't change our communities, if we can't change our hearts and minds. And so I really feel passionate about the first step is looking within ourselves and how we show up and how we see others. And these conversations have brought tools and resources for people to really think about that. And I think that's important because until we do that, we're not going to be able to see change, right? So I'm, again, happy to be here, Tracy. Love what you're doing. And just excited to be a part of this conversation again. So thank you.
Thank you so much. Mr. Lennox Scott, I wanted you to know that you're actually one of the reasons that between you and Reggie Williams, the two of you were the catalyst for how I actually changed the focus of the conversation. Each of you leaned in with this idea of resilience. We have doctors who are on, Pam as well, who you've been doing this work for decades, right? But Lennox, when I met you, you talked about living life as a contribution. And one of the things that got me excited is that you were willing to put your, you know, money where your mouth is. Like you actually funded some of the work that we're doing right now that's gonna allow us to turn these amazing conversations into videos and into training assets that will actually change the world. So Lennox, tell us who you are and why is this work so important to you?
Well, my name's Lennox Scott, CEO of John L. Scott Real Estate. And we have, our footprint is Washington, Oregon, Idaho, and now in Los Angeles for residential real estate. So for me personally, the shock of the horrific death of George Floyd made an imprint on me, and as it did an inflection point for society. And there's kind of a process that you go through. And, you know, first of all, with the shock, and then the conversations with individuals within the company and my kids and millennials and everything. And then you get into awareness level of with the other team members in the company, education, getting awareness level and education, and then understanding. And the biggest understanding I got, you know, was watching the videos and the conversations and everything, but it was actually reading the book, The Color of Law, that really gave me the history, because I did not know the history. I did not grow up with this as a history, so I had to get a foundation, and that just created greater inspiration to get us into action, to move forward with our thoughts as a company, but it even to get into greater action and the conversation within the real estate industry and CEO groups around.
Love it. Love it, love it, love it. Thank you so much for that. Miss Michelle Avon, you've also been one of those individuals who has, I really do feel like I'm the luckiest woman in the world, because when you guys speak and you speak with your truth, it's just like, it just soothes my soul, because these are the courageous conversations that we have in order to make it a norm, right? People are going to normalize. And we'll have Pam, when I come to you, we're going to talk about why this conversation is so important. But Miss Michelle, tell us who you are and tell us if you had one message to give to a corporate CEO, why we need to move from these courageous conversations to courageous actions, actually changing the status quo, what would you say?
So first of all, I have to say that the opinions that are expressed are mine and not that of my employer.
Well, wait a minute. Let me just say that is the case for everyone on this call. So let me put the official disclaimer out there. We are individuals representing right. ourselves. Unless you, John L. Scott might be representing John L. Scott Realty, but for the rest of us, we're not, right? As individuals, we're going to assume that that is the case for all of us. And you clarify if that's different, but thank you for that.
Absolutely. So again, my name is Michelle Avan, and I am West Division Supervision Executive at Merrill Lynch, and we're a subsidiary of Bank of America. And Traci, I am also appreciative and honored to be part of the series of conversations that you have been having. And thank you so much for putting this together, because it definitely is necessary. We have to have these conversations. And so to the gentleman who spoke before me as the CEO of a company in accountability, I have to give you a round of applause for that. Kudos to you, because why is it important for CEOs to talk about it? Because it is very much a part of who and what we are. I think often CEOs, they don't really quite gravitate and understand that what is happening in society and the real world actually plays out in the corporate space. And that's a huge miss when we're not able to see the correlation of what people are experiencing in their personal lives, how that also has an impact and it translates into who and what they are in the corporate space. Listen, studies and statistics show that when you have diverse organizations and you give your teammates and your employees an opportunity to be very real and true and authentic to themselves, there are a number of different things that happen from it. One, you get a better body and collective body of work. You get more better output. They're happier. They're more enthusiastic about coming into the office. It translates into less sick days. They're more productive. They're better human beings, and then they are better individuals for the organization and the health of the organization. So it's mental, it's physiological, it benefits the organization, and it is just the right thing to do. Not because it helps to tick your number to show that you've met the quota to count the different minorities that you have, but that really from a holistic perspective, you just have a better societal group of people that feel more included. We talk a lot about diversity. It's the inclusion piece. And we're also starting to hear more about the equity piece that as a people, as business owners, as CEOs, we really got to get this thing right, because if not you leading from the front, then who? And people are following you as CEO. So when you do something, somebody else is going to do it. And we've got to start making sure that we don't only have Black people in this conversation and at the forefront of it, but more importantly, people that don't look like us. This is a humanitarian crisis that we have to fix. So we all have to do it together. Thank you, Traci.
I love you guys. You see why I'm so blessed? Each of you are fantastic. So I am going to, I was going to bring on Bill, but Bill, I'm going to swap it up real quick. I'm going to bring on Erica, because I know Erica has to leave in just a few minutes, and it's a perfect flow to what Michelle just shared. So Erica, you're a white female, and I said, I need a white female who's in a leadership role to join us today, and you said, I'm in, count me in, and we literally just met yesterday. Am I right?
You are right.
And let me tell you. So, and it was amazing. And our conversation was like, oh my God, this is the piece of the puzzle that we've been missing. So I came into this space and I've been talking about this idea of urgency, right? We need to have some urgency around this conversation. We have done tons of research. We, you know, the National Black MBA has led think tanks around the challenges. So we know about unconscious bias, unequal performance standards, similarity bias, the lack of CEO accountability. We know about all these things. We know that about the business case for diversity. Companies that are more diverse are more profitable, they're more successful. But yet we've been having this same conversation for decades. So this Bigger Than Me success series is really about cutting through the true systemic change. It's really about creating a safe space for each of us to learn and to grow together. And it's not about Black people having this conversation. It really has to be leaders who don't look like us, who get that there's a change needed, who can also be advocates and allies and really driving change. So Erica, I teared up yesterday almost when you mentioned, because this was not a prompted conversation, but you said, I have a need. And I was like, yes, tell us a little bit about who you are and what need did you find in your organization?
Sure. And Tracy, thank you so much for having me. And you're right, we met yesterday and I feel like the stars aligned and I'm really happy to be here. Hope that this community will embrace me and I'm excited to be part of what you're doing. It's really important work. So my name is Erica Stricker. I'm a senior managing director at CBRE, which is a corporate real estate firm. I run a large organization that supports Microsoft across the globe. And you know, we've had D&I as a top line goal in our team for years. And I would say in predominantly over the last couple of years, I put a lot of energy and effort into it. And I would say, you know, pat ourselves on the back for all the great work that we've been doing to say this is important. Fast forward to this year. And I said, I really need to start looking at the information, like the numbers. So we can say we're doing all the right things. We can talk about it. We can put programs in place. We can support our hiring managers and tell them the right ways of interviewing, do unconscious bias training, do all the things. But what is really happening in our organization? And I saw the data and it made me lose my breath because it wasn't where I expected it to be. It's not where I want it to be. And it's not where it should be. You know, pockets of my organization have great diversity. But there are other pockets of my organization that don't at all. And the bigger problem is that I have a hole in the bucket issue where I've got a larger percentage and ratio of individuals that are diverse, both ethnic and racial, that are leaving the organization over those that are not. And so I am now in the process of taking this journey to a completely different place, which is we have a lot of work still to do. And we might have thought that we had our things figured out and the programs in place that we needed to do, but guess what? We don't. And there is a lot more work to be done. I'm obviously reaching out and getting others in the boat with me because this is a long journey for us. And I'm excited for what the future will bring. One of the things that you, Tracy, and I chatted about yesterday was the fact that we've also, on a similar path, been on a safety journey. So for those that don't know the corporate real estate world, I have quite a few individuals that are doing inherently hazardous work on a day-to-day basis. And so safety is a really important part of what we do. And we talk about safety a lot. But up until the last few years, people have thought about safety in terms of compliance, regulations, making sure that we've got risk management. And people were getting hurt. And so putting sort of the stick aspect into that conversation wasn't working. And so we took a step back and I said, look, this is about people. This is about caring about individuals. This is about me saying that you as a person in my team, I want you to go home in the same or better condition than when you came to work. I care about you as a person. I care about the people that you love. I care that you have a wonderful weekend, not that you're doing great work here. I care that you have a life outside of this. And I think that our DE&I space is turning to that as well. It's about caring of the person and the individual and what makes them the best in their life. How am I helping to support them reach their potential? And making my organization a place where everybody of all kinds wants to come and do their best work.
Erica, I wanted to know, I took you off spotlight for a second there because I went back to gallery view and every head was nodding. We call that I'm a Southern girl. We call that the amen corner. So I actually saw every head nodding saying, yes, exactly right. It is about safety. It is about thinking differently. And so, you know, one of the conversations that we've had and that I have emphasized with this community is I created a term called it's called a corporate chokehold. And it was basically a label that I used to describe those known key challenges, the things that we talk about really academically, unconscious bias, unequal performance standards, similarity bias, a lack of leadership accountability. All of the research says those are the four challenges that not only prevent advancement within corporate America, but causes trauma in corporate America. Yet oftentimes, you know, many people don't believe that there is a problem. So when you mention safety, it's like, that's the conversation that we're trying to emphasize is just the current culture creates an unsafe space. That's why I have some doctors on today. We've had mental health specialists on, right? This idea of really, you know, choosing to have a different conversation is huge. And what I loved about you, Erica, you said as well, you're like, hey, I'm willing to put my money where my mouth is, right? I'm not going to just talk about hiring people because that's what you reached out to me about. You actually reached out because you said you wanted to to Seattle. I didn't even introduce myself. I don't know. I am president of the Seattle chapter of the Black MBA, and Erica reached out because she has a role that she was posting, and you wanted to truly drive change. And I love that. So Erica, tell us a little bit about, last thing, like, just exactly how serious are you about actually driving change?
I mean, I don't know how else to say, but beyond 100%, like 1,000%. Like, if we don't change, I'm not here to do what I'm meant to do, which is to serve the communities in which we work in and make this world a better place. You talk about change. You talk about that this is a movement. We talk about how, you know, we are here to make the world better. I'm here to make the world better. Otherwise, what the heck am I doing each and every day? I would say that this year has been eye-opening for me. I would say I lived in the Pacific Northwest bubble. I didn't realize how inequitable it is, and it has been heavy on my heart. And so I sat, I think, in that space for a little while where I was like, I cannot believe how under a rock I have been. But guess what? Now's the time for me to stand up, be a part of the change, and do what I need to do to make this place better.
Woo, don't you love my people? Woo, I love them. You guys are all amazing. That's all I can say. Each and every one of you are absolutely amazing. Bill Wells, I'm going to go to you next. Bill, you've been a part of this initiative for a while. Give us a quick introduction, if you don't mind, and tell us who are you. But Bill, real quick, for those who may not think there's a challenge, is there a problem and is there a solution? Like, do you believe that now is the time to really drive change?
Well, absolutely. First of all, for those of you just joining us, I'm Bill Wells, former leader with the National Black MBA Association, both at the chapter level and national level. Served on the national board for 9 years, chairman is 7 or so. And in my day work, I'm a DEI, a diversity and equity and inclusion practitioner. I've been doing this work quite some time. So I know, Traci, you asked me to speak to the challenge and the opportunity, and I'm going to veer just a little bit and move away from comfortable conversation, and maybe not even courageous conversation, but hard conversation. Let me just suggest to anyone on this call that if they think that racism and the effects of racism are new in this country, I'm not sure where you've been. And I get it that, you know, we've had people isolated in so-called bubbles regionally, geographically, but even more so emotionally and intellectually. They've lived in their bubble of privilege for so long that they have not allowed themselves to peer into the reality. The civil rights movement is over 50 plus years. This conversation that we're having today took place then in a different form, but it's much of the same thing. So when I speak about the challenge isn't anything other than strictly commitment and leadership commitment. I'm not willing to let the CEOs off the hook. I get it that most of them are really dialed in on corporate results and in profitability. But quite frankly, there's enough research that's out there that they are aware of that says that there's more to it than just profit. Behind me, you can kind of see, I think, a magazine, and it says How to Lead with Purpose. That's a special issue that was put together by the Harvard Business Review back in the spring, early spring of this year. And the primary focus in that article is, and it's a really good article, I recommend anybody look it up, and anybody on this call look it up, because it speaks more to about a shift from corporate social responsibility to organizations creating greater social value. And that's a big distinction. So one is kind of the obligatory, you know, what's my social responsibility for having a franchise to operate my business in this space versus me as an active participant in society? What value do I bring? What social value do I bring? So I'm just going to leave it kind of, when we talk about moving from talk to action, that has to be, it's not for the people on this call necessarily, but it's for those people who are in a leadership position that have the opportunity to make change and make change happen through their organizations. And how do they do that? They have to share a vision, and they have to share a vision with others who are part of the leadership team. And then it trickles down to the organization. it's not even about having a DEI initiative or a program in place. Some of them, and one of the speakers before me said it and captured it, it's not about legal compliance, because legal compliance really did not accomplish much of anything. But it's also, we've moved away from compliance to really what helps to grow organizations. There are a couple of things. So the challenge that I see is for us to move off that dime of having the conversation about why is this important. Tragically and sadly, George Floyd lost his life for us to have this heightened awareness in this conversation. George Floyd was murdered about three blocks from my church. And Traci, you may remember, Pam may remember as well. My church, we decided to do something immediately, and that was to address the situation. The murder occurred on Monday. On Saturday, we held our first town hall on race in Minneapolis. I mean, we put together it really quick with the help of our great friend, Carol Copeland Thomas, another Black MBA member. She's up in Boston. We put together, and on Saturday, 4 days, 5 days later after the murder, we held a conversation. Over close to 4,000 people globally joined that call. It was on a Saturday evening. So I guess what I'm saying is we've got to move to action. That action looks like a different things. I've got a number of notes here, Traci, that I've put together, but I think in order to keep this thing moving, I want to make sure the others have a chance to talk. Maybe you'll come back, because there are some key things that have happened here just recently, and on a national level and local level. And I believe they're probably happening in some of the communities of the different speakers there on this call. So if you don't mind, I'll hold on to some of this other information. I don't want to keep just speaking, but the opportunity on the face of the challenge, the opportunity is for the leaders, and everybody on this call is a leader in a sense, but we've got to create an awareness and a racial awareness and a commitment to move the dime. We don't need more education. I mean, I don't know how much we're going to keep doing this. I mean, it's like people know, they choose not to know, or they choose to remain in the bubble, and they choose not to do anything. So I've got some other information to share when we kind of circle back. I hope this makes sense.
It's been absolutely perfect. So Erica, I know you have two more minutes before you have to go. So I'm going to ask you a final little courageous conversation, courageous element to this, because you blew my mind. Like I said, you're my sister from another mother now. We're officially family, okay? It's official. So, Ms. Erica, can you tell me, based on what Bill just said, does it give you more excitement to want to drive change? Does it make you nervous in any way that we've been having this conversation, that this isn't new information? Like, what are you, as someone who's like, you know, I'm seeing the numbers maybe for the first time, I'm seeing something differently for the first time, how do you honestly feel about your ability to drive change?
I feel all the emotions, right? So I feel like I'm in the best possible position to drive change, right? I think I spoke to you yesterday about the fact that while a lot of our positions currently are on hold from a hiring perspective, we're probably going to hire more people the latter half of 2021 than we ever have, because of, you know, coming back into the workplace and all that. And so for me, it's like, I feel this energy around getting things in place that are going to drive the right kind of behaviors and the right kind of inclusive behaviors to retain the individuals that we have today and retain the individuals that we're going to hire tomorrow. I also have a lot of fear in that this is, I'm trying to move a team of 1,500 in a direction that I want to go, and I need help to get there, because it's not just my voice. What Bill talked about was it's each and every individual, and this individual accountability, getting people to care and want to take that accountability and drive the change within their teams. That part definitely gives me some challenge. But if we're not here to be challenged and we're not here to take on the hard stuff, like, what are we here to do? One of my favorite things that I like to say is I like to run to the bullet. I'm not going to shy away from a challenge. You just got to get in front of it and get it done. And so I would say I'm feeling all of the emotions, excitement, panic, inspiration by being with all of you today, hope. But we just got to get out there and do it.
I love it.
It's been too long.
I love it. Thank you so much for your time. I said I'd get you off officially by 10:30. But we're going to continue this conversation after the official 2 hours. Some of us are going to stay on. We're going to continue. So anyone who wants to stay on, whether you're an attendee or a panelist, we're going to actually bring some of the attendees in as well into the conversation at that time. So super excited. Thank you for joining us. And I'm excited about our next steps. Thank you. Okay. Mr. Reggie Williams. I have to find you again. Did we lose Reggie? Reggie is gone. Okay. So the next person that I was going to bring up is Mrs. Pam McElvane. Pam, what I love about you and what I love about everything that you do is that you are 100% focused on, you've been doing this work for a while. And during our last session, I love that blouse, by the way. You look lovely. and you're muted, I believe.
Did you say I'm not.
Okay, thank you. You just mouth some happiness, some joy. That's the other thing I love about you guys is this session is about resilience and radiance. Again, Bill's been in the game for decades, right? We've been talking about this for decades, yet you see, he's still radiant, right? We're still positive. There's still a joy and an optimism that we can truly drive change. Now, one of the things you said in our last session, which I want to, toward the end, I want to kind of use that as some grounding as we move forward so people understand why we're having the conversation we're having, why we have to step up and be a leader, is you talked about this idea of trust and hope and safety. And you mentioned something, a quote around only 8 to 10% of Black people are actually comfortable enough to truly tell their truth. Tell us a little bit more about those numbers. What does that mean and why is this so important?
Well, first, let me say thank you for inviting me back once again, Traci. And every time I participate, the panel is, I'm more in awe. And also to see some of my esteemed colleagues from the past. And did you hear that, Bill? She said, you've been in it for decades. So, you know, I'm behind you.
Introduce yourself. Be sure you introduce yourself. I forgot that part. Tell us who you are as well.
So I'm Pam McElvane, CEO of Diversity MBA Media, Diversity Learning Solutions. We do research on the best places to work, Fortune 1000 companies, for the intersection of women and people of color in the workplace. We also have 4 publications that we publish monthly, about 2 million reach in our audience. And we take our original data and create learning solutions for organizations. So from some of the insights that Traci is speaking to is based on some of the work that we do. So it's organizational work, and then we also go into the culture and individual. So 76% of companies, we've seen a 40% rise in courageous conversations due to the heightened awareness of the Black experience of the social unrest and injustices that's been existing and brought to life recently, that's been going on for all our lives that are in Black America. We've experienced this from day one, start to take care of our children. Once they get to an age that they can be stopped and recognize a hate crime, recognize an inequity. So that is where our experience lends itself. So within the courageous conversations that companies are having, some of the work that we did, and we polled thousands of employees from all groups, all dimensions of diversity, participated in the polls as they were employees of the corporations. And one of the questions we asked them all consistently and had them poll and rate is psychological safety within their organizations to discuss the issues, the societal issues that's going on and how they spilled over within the workplace, to also to discuss how safe do they feel in addressing micro inequities that they're faced with, both on a daily basis in and or outside of the work. So most of them were saying that, so what happened, we enormously found, and we weren't surprised, that we found that more than 70% of white Americans, both male and female, feel pretty comfortable in addressing any inequities that they feel to their superiors or to their direct report. And then we'll just drill down. Of course, other people in the middle, other ethnic groups in the middle ranged in about 30%, varying in those ranges. But African-Americans, Blacks, were 8 to 10%. And the biggest fear they had were immediate retaliation. Even after sharing that this is what's going on. Here's the courageous conversations that we're having. You're asking for my authentic truth. Here is my truth. As a Black woman, I get hit with being an angry Black woman just by being passionate and sharing my belief. I see in different in healthcare systems, they say right there in the front intake, I'm sitting there and I hear colleagues talking, using racist terms, telling jokes, making statements every day. So they go on and they shared many, many stories and said, there's no way I could go and say, hey, this is not right. You know, you're wrong. They're not comfortable always in educating for everything that they hear from other groups, in fear that they will be tagged. Even today, they feel that they're hopeful. We're hopeful. They're hopeful, but the organizations just aren't there yet for them to continually, on a continual basis, and without having a structure or framework to just mention how they honestly feel. So I'll stop right there, Traci.
Thank you. That's amazing. That is amazing. So what I loved about what you just shared is this idea that we all, you can't expect people to actually say what they're actually experiencing, right? Due to fear of safety, et cetera. Dr. Beverly is the next person I'm actually going to bring up. Dr. Beverly, can you tell us a little bit about the physical and psychological impacts of exclusion, of inequities? I think you were the one who mentioned the term weathering to me. This is where my term corporate chokeholds comes from. It's like, guys, we know these things are happening. We've been talking about it for decades. A corporate chokehold by definition says, take your knee off my neck. Really, like you can't keep doing those things and not expect bad things to happen. So what are some of the things that happen, Dr. Beverly? What can you share with us?
Hi, everyone. My expertise is in diabetes and heart disease and the impacts on the body and what leads to these things that seem to happen or appear overnight, but it's taken years and decades for a person's blood sugar to become out of control or for heart disease, heart attack, strokes. There's always things that precede it that lead up to the event that then gets people's attention, and they often think it comes out of the blue. So the idea of weathering and safety, let's weave that together. There's very real physiological experiences of stress, of feeling helpless, perhaps, or out of control, of feeling demeaned, not valued. And when one is not included, you have changes in a person's hormones and other physiological systems. So their blood pressure rises and it goes up and up. And if this happens enough and a person becomes weathered, i.e. they're getting worn out from this experience, they're not able to refresh and renew, then this can cause harm. They get sick. And so then that person now will have hypertension, have chronic experience of high blood pressure. Similarly, they'll have their cholesterol go up, all of this in response to stress. When we are stressed, and if it's the kind of stress where we're not in charge of it, so it's not the excited kind of stress, like some wonderful life event is about to happen and you're excited, although it's stressful, it's good stress, it's eustress. I'm talking about distress. So when there's a negative impact from stress, where someone is treated unfairly, where there are comments made that are quite harmful, and maybe the people saying them aren't intentionally, not trying to be harmful, but that's the result. And if the person brings it up and says, hey, that was really like not cool, let me share with you another way to say it, or how about we don't even do that? And the work is often put on that person who's in the minority position, who's not feeling included and valued. So what'll change is their hormonal background will change, their release of a particular stress hormone called cortisol. That releases, guess what? Blood sugar. When you have extra blood sugar, glucose released, you get more insulin. Next thing you know, this person is on a treadmill, a steady on-ramp, if you will, to pre-diabetes and then type 2 diabetes. They're also more likely to be primed for chronic high blood pressure. And we know that African Americans, specifically in the U.S., have 4 to 5 times the incidence of high blood pressure compared to any other group. It's really stunning. If you look at people of African heritage in other parts of the world, you don't see that. There's nowhere near that disparity in outcomes. So there are things that happen specifically here in the U.S. So it's not a surprise to me as an African-American woman who's a naturopathic physician that these are the results. Of course it is. One of the things Traci and I talked about before about systems and designs, right? So when you have a system and it's designed, you get the outputs that the system was designed to put out. And so in this case, we really need to look at what's happening and address it systemically and treat the roots of the problem, the actual causes of the problem, and not just the symptoms. So the high blood pressure, the higher incidence of pre-diabetes, type 2 diabetes, those are all symptoms. And if we look at a corporate world in which people feel included and their values, their contributions are valued, then you get a much better outcome. This drops to the bottom line. This means that healthcare costs drop, which is a big deal. In this country, a tremendous amount of money is spent on things like diabetes and heart disease and other potentially stress-related illnesses. So in the corporate world, anything we can do to make people feel valued and included, and to understand sometimes that there will be uncomfortable moments and that that's okay, that's part of growth. You know, if you think about it, in our childhoods, right, all of us on this panel are clearly fully formed, amazing adults. And in your adult life, you had to go through puberty to get there. Was that not awkward and uncomfortable? Yeah, it was awkward and uncomfortable, but it was necessary. You know, the caterpillar has to go through a transformation to become the beautiful butterfly. So we really, as a culture, want to have everyone's contributions and get those improved bottom line results, more profits for the corporate world, more inclusion for employees, a sense of safety. When people don't feel safe, they don't contribute. And when they do contribute, if they feel like they're constantly either ignored or crushed, and this often happens for various ethnic minorities, it certainly happens for women, no question about that. You know, it means then that you get that much better of a final result. All the studies, as another speaker had shared, have shown very conclusively, you get better products, you get more sales, you get happier employees, you have less turnover. That means there's less in the way of onboarding and training costs. And because if you've got, like, I think it was Erica earlier was saying that there was a hole in the bucket where people come into the corporation, but they leave. And so they can't hire enough people new to come in because people are dissatisfied and leaving. She's being really insightful about that and hopefully going to be able to do something about it, because that constant turnover, that churn and burn is never a good thing, but it shows up in people's health. Then you've got all these prescription costs for high cholesterol, blood sugar, all these other drugs. And I mean, these medicines are expensive. The impact on people's lives is expensive. I honestly wish one of my fondest wishes is that we could lead with just the simple statement of it's the right thing to do. But for however many, 400 plus years, 500 plus years, that has not been a sufficient reason. So I think we need to find something else that's compelling and for people to understand that it's for everyone to win. Like when one of us wins, we all win. That's going to include all the diaspora for Black people, the African-Americans and people from other parts of the world of African heritage. That's going to include our Asian heritage folks, our Latino heritage folks, you know, immigrants from wherever they may be, people of different religious and spirituality, all of it, you know, different sexual orientation.
Women. I mean, I think it's important to talk about women, every aspect.
We need everyone at the table. Yeah.
And that's the one thing that all the research has proven, to your point, is, you know, it's critical that we focus on the most marginalized, because when you raise the ecosystem for that group, then everyone benefits. So that's a given, and I love you.
And sometimes you just need one contribution, one contradiction to be able to feel like you're included and can find your voice. And you know, I will give a simple example. We have a real estate agent we'd worked with when we were first married. We were 24, about to turn 25, living in Portland, Oregon. She is currently, I believe, a real estate agent with John L. Scott Real Estate. And she is still the one real estate person who's been a hero for me personally. She was fabulous. She navigated us through all the possibilities so we did not get redlined, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. She was great. And I would love to tell you about your rock star real estate agent. That was not our other experience, okay?
I love that. Thank you.
So just want to say, sometimes that makes a difference.
It makes all the difference, actually. And I got two people who are going to come up next. Kay Hirai is going to be right after Dr. Irene Kopp, but I actually wanted to bring in this conversation. So Dr. Irene, to pivot, I met both you and Beverly and Jonni through this Beyond TV boot camp, through Chris Winfield and Jen Gottlieb, and it's been such an amazing blessing. So I just want to say thank you for each of you to also kind of lean in. So Dr. Irene, when people look at you at face value, you look like a blonde, beautiful blonde woman, and you said with a little bit of a neck roll, but I'm also Aboriginal. I also have an Aboriginal background. And then you started to share, and people are not aware of the impact, right, that actually happens when these type of exclusions happen. And then you also reference things that we talk about. Someone calls it, Dr. Jordan DeGru, I think, calls it post-traumatic slave syndrome. But you talked about just the scientific research around the generational trauma that's passed down. So can you tell us a little bit about who you are and what you do and why is this conversation around resilience and suffering, right, that it's a real thing and that we can move through it?
Thank you so much, Traci. I really appreciate being included as part of this amazing panel, and thank you so much for bringing it all together. I have been taking copious notes and learning so much myself and loving all the different perspectives and going, oh my goodness, I want to talk about this and this and this and this. And Dr. Beverly.
More specifically, I want you to actually talk about the thing that we discussed regarding your doctor. So let's talk about what research says about trauma that's passed on. Give us that reference to the rats.
Will do. I'm Dr. Irene, and because of my own catastrophic burnout, I founded the Flame Out Project because I recognized that there is far more to burnout and chronic stress than just workplace and psycho-emotional impacts, because my own catastrophic car accident happened because of physical burnout. And Dr. Beverly just did a phenomenal job of showing you just how chronic stress impacts your body, from high blood pressure to cardiovascular disease to diabetes to autoimmune disease to cancer to increased infections to inflammation and pain, so much. Our highest, greatest killers are actually caused or greatly exacerbated by stress. So thank you so much, Dr. Beverly. A huge part of that stress is trauma, as Traci commented and a number of you have. And through my work, I'm very passionate, especially about PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder. And that can be from your own experiences, as far as Dr. Beverly said, and others have said about not feeling safe to speak, constantly feeling like you have to be vigilant, not only about what you say, but you know where you go, what's going to happen, like the fear that is always simmering below the surface and at times is like fully in your face. And what I have noticed from working with my clients, whether they're veterans or people who have gone through adversity, and then of course, cultural and ethnic, is that there is more to PTSD and trauma than just our own experiences. There is the generational PTSD of our parents, for instance, and our grandparents and what they experienced and socialized us to. That's a fancy word of saying, in other words, they were fearful, they reacted a certain way, they had these experiences, and they, that programming then entered into you as you were a child and downloaded. And what they now realize is there's something that I've coined called epigenetic PTSD. And that is, there was a beautiful study that showed that, and I won't go into the details right now, but it showed that even if you never met one of your ancestors, so that they could directly impact you with their own PTSD, it actually changes their adverse experiences that they had. Think of slaves or my own Aboriginal ancestors who were forced marched along the Trail of Tears. Think about what they went through. And knowing that that actually changed the DNA, modified it so that it gets transmitted down genetically to you. So what I'm passionate about is helping people heal from their own PTSD, and then heal the generational and then the epigenetic PTSD, so that we can heal not only ourselves, but our corporations, our companies, our culture. And it's all very, very important that we start with one person at a time, because that's all that has ever changed and healed the world.
I love that. So Dr. Irene, I know when you and I were talking, you spoke specifically about some research that I had done as well. Do you want to tell us a little bit about the rats? The passing down, it was kind of Pavlov's the idea of, do you know what I'm talking about?
I do. That was the research that I mentioned, but I need
I need the specifics because it was so visual. I heard you skip it, so I wanted to come back to it because it really does bring a visual. Because people are like, yeah, really? Mm-hmm. So research is research, and this is Harvard research. It's like every academic institution has done similar research. It's been proven over and over again. So these aren't just ideals; these are facts. Like, we know this to be true. So just tell us real quick, the short version of that research.
So, Cole's Notes version. This research, it was a beautifully simple experiment that on the face of it started with Pavlovian conditioning. For those of you who know the story about Pavlov, who, you know, rang a bell and each time he fed his dogs, so that to the point where all he had to do is ring the bell without the food and they would start salivating. So this research study, unfortunately for the animal lovers, used rats. And what they did was that they would ring a bell and the rats would have no reaction. But then they started delivering shocks at the same time as ringing the bell, to the point where even without the shock, ringing the bell, they would show the fear response and try and move away. That is straight Pavlovian conditioning. The difference is that then these researchers took the grandchildren rats that had never had any contact with the parents or grandparents, rang the bell, and they showed the fear response. So there was no way that that response could have been modeled by the grandchildren because there was no contact. In other words, it had to be something that had become hardwired in them. Mm-hmm. So the beautiful thing is, and this goes to neurophysiology, and Dr. Beverly, you know, could speak to this as well, that there's something called a neuroplasticity, that nerves that fire together wire together, which means that ringing the bell and delivering the shock together created those nerves to come together to the limbic system, which houses the pain, and then the amygdala, which has the emotions, and then the memory, the hippocampus, and created this thing like this, right? This hardwired, think of it like a highway of information that went, oh, ring bell, I have to do this to get away. It's gonna be hurt. It's gonna, right? I have to survive. The beautiful thing is that nerves that fire together, but all at the same time, they can be pruned back so that you no longer need to experience that. So this is what they realize in PTSD, is that you don't get rid of the memories, you just disconnect the emotions from the memories, and in that case, the pain. So this is so important to know that we can heal from this. And I loved what one of my colleagues on the panel said about, you know, this is where the action comes in. It's important to have the awareness and the understanding. And then at some point we need to move to action and to healing on all levels.
Don't you love my people? I get so excited. All of you are so amazing. So in my head, I've had like thousands and thousands of interviews. So I'm just kind of like connecting the dots. So if you think about the reason the words corporate chokehold, right? The reason I trademarked those terms, because I believe exactly what she said. I have read all the research from Harvard. I know that the trauma that we experience, these unconscious bias, the exclusion, the unequal performance standards, it's traumatic. And I know it's traumatic because I had my own traumatic experience. I literally sat across from interns who wanted to commit suicide based on their experience in corporate America, right? Based on their unconscious bias, based on unequal performance standards. And honestly, I just know that it's, you know, we have to drive change. Like, we can do things differently. And that's really what this initiative is about. It's not about courageous conversations alone. It's about using those courageous conversations to generate another term called courageous activations, right? Things that we can do that will truly drive change, that will help us to move from the traumatic experiences, right? The things that both Pam and Dr. Irene just mentioned, right? We know that they're happening. We've been talking about them for 40 years, right? We know the experiences, but we can do some things to change it. And I just want to bring up my next guest, who is Kay Hirai. Ms. Kay, What I love about you is you and I work together. Where's Kay? There she is. I'm going to spotlight you real quick. Okay, there you go. Oh, so I'm going to remove my spotlight. So it's just you. Okay, so Ms. Kay, can you share with us who you are, and then tell us, why is this work so important, and what have you done to actually drive change? Because I know you've actually made this a personal mission. You've used your business as a mission for societal change. Tell us about that.
Hi, Traci, and I've been really enjoying and learning a lot from everybody that's on this panel. So thank you for all that you are doing. And from my point of view, I am a owner of a small business. I actually own a very unique hair salon that incorporates philosophy to more than doing hair. And so, I am a SCORE mentor for the Small Business Administration with Traci, so I know her very well. And I just wanted to say that one word that probably could express what I do is a book that I wrote, and it's a book about my business. It's called Sheer Determination, Swimming Upstream in a Downstream World. And I've owned my business for 40 years plus, and from the onset of my business, I knew that I wanted to build a business that was based on my values. And my values was all these things that we are talking about, the inclusion, diversity, equity. And that was what I had in mind, because I felt as though my business is a vehicle that creates societal changes. And it's in my mission, it's in the philosophy, it's in a training of all my staff. And I agree with Bill Wells when he talked about how these changes have to come from the top, because, you know, I think everybody could have these certain things that they believe in and wanna do, but in a company, when that person leaves, it just leaves. But if the company itself created the value within your procedures and processes and your mission statements, it will carry on long after every employee leaves. And so my business, I feel that it is a vehicle. We have 3,000 customers on our mailing list, and it's a way for me to communicate our philosophy to them. And I've always, I think one of the things that people don't really understand is people understand, okay, we have to do this, but how? They don't understand what it's really like. Even some of the leaders in businesses don't really understand, how do you show this on an everyday basis so that people could actually see what's going on? And for me, you know, one of the things that I share with Traci is I've always hired with inclusion in mind. And we wore t-shirts for many years that said, many cultures, one team. So every time every one of our clients came in, they really knew what we were all about. And one thing I wanted to share with you was that I hired a African-American male from the military, and I really wanted to help him. And he was such a great person. I hired him. And what I do is I train and I mentor Antoine. And I must tell you that it was the toughest thing I have ever done, because when the customers call in to schedule, if they receive somebody of color or somebody who didn't speak English or something like that, one customer actually came up and refused to pay. And I said, why? This person did wonderful work on your hair. And she was so excited to work on your hair. And Antoine is so excited to do your hair too. And this person said to me, I want you to give me somebody that is, basically what he was trying to say was somebody who has blonde hair. And I just said to him, you know, I'm really sorry. This is what we do. And if you don't want to pay, please leave. And we are not welcome back into my business anymore. Next day, he called and he apologized and he came back in to pay. But I do stand very firmly against what we believe in our business. And we practice it and we show it every day to our clients. And there are so many people now that's always now saying to me, gosh, I'm really sorry I acted that way. And they all, you know, our beings have change of hearts. They know what we stand for. And so I feel that for me personally, to create societal change like this takes every single day of not talking, but acting, showing people, sharing with people. And that's how I feel that we've lasted for 40 years plus, because most businesses, you know, just they go under after 3 to 5. And we have lasted, and it's because the community embraced my business and the people that work for me. And so I mean, this is just a small token of what I feel like I could do, and I'm doing it.
Well, okay, first of all, I know you have to leave early, but we're going to have you back, obviously. This conversation with each of you, we're obviously continuing this work. And as I mentioned at the beginning, we're using this work, we're using this initiative, we're doing this specifically to change the status quo, right? We're creating a video series, we're creating a... I'm trying to spotlight my next person. We're creating a video series. We have a book that's being written. This is super exciting. So I will definitely have you each back. You each have an amazing story. And did you guys love how, you know, what she said was she's intentionally driving change. You talk to the customer, but Kay, when I have you back, you also had a courageous conversation with the employee about what he could do differently. So your courageous conversations are at all levels. You're doing the work. It's amazing. So again,
it is my job to help my employees from being put down by the world. And they have to face it every day. And I am there as their mentor, trying to keep their courage up, asking them to do the right things, asking them to fit in. And those are the kind of things that I do every day to keep my employees of color sustained so that they don't really, I guess, come down under the stress of how the world sees them.
Do you hear what she's saying and why she's saying and how she's actually driving real change? I love this so much. And I think one of the things is there's an acknowledgement that there's a change. So Lennox, you're nodding your head over there. What are you thinking? Why are you nodding your head so feverishly? You're like, yeah, I see it. What are you thinking?
Well, I think society is ready for change. I think CEOs and corporations are ready for change. We just need to take them up a level, their energy up a level. So if they fully get it, then it's part of who they are. The organizations are talking about change, but we want the CEOs to be with intention to say, this is what we're going to do. This is what the positive outcome looks like. And we're intentionally going to invite people in for inclusion to the leadership meetings, to the leadership institutes, the education to be able to move forward in their careers when they're within the companies and trade associations. We're using this inflection point in society, the inspiration we have personally as a company to influence our trade association nationwide. We have 1.4 million members nationwide. We can make an impact in society. We need mandatory diversity education. We haven't had that to support fair housing. I'm an advocate for that. And we're influencing the diversity committees at state and national to move that forward, to read the book, The Color of Law, to really help everyone go to the next level to implement, come up with ideas for inclusion, which will lead to equity.
I love it, love it, love it, love it. Thank you. And when I first had my first conversation with you, Lennox, what really impressed me, and again, you're going to be a part of this initiative moving forward, clearly, you're like the big hit here. I hear all these comments, and I see a lot of comments in the chat about you. What you're doing is you're not just talking about change, you're actually doing change. And that's what this is about. It's really about all of us continuing to drive change. So thank you so much for that. The reason I wanted to bring you on before I bring my next guest on is because on the flyer, there was this concept of resilience and the concept of radiance, right? And so the idea of radiance is how we show up, right? And some people think that's really associated with women, but it's really about this light and this joy. And when we first had our conversation, you talked about all the challenges that existed, but you also talked about what you needed to do to drive change. So thank you for bringing this divine connection to really wanting to be a contribution. So thank you for that. So Miss Debrina Jackson Gandy, one of my favorite people, how are you?
Marvelous. Hello, hello. Hello,
how are you? So just by the way, so we're going to be, this initiative, this Bigger Than Me success series, it started out with a series of sessions, and I mentioned from the very beginning, we were creating a video series, a series of books. We're actually creating this online community. So all of you will be migrated into an online community where additional masterminds will take place. If you love what someone was talking about on a particular area, you can go deeper, right? You can learn from Kay. You can learn from this woman right here, because this woman talks about, you want to introduce yourself to Brina real quick and tell us about this idea of change. Change isn't always so easy, but when we think about equity and inclusion, doing this hard work, you talk about doing things with flow, with positive radiance, you know, attracting the things that you want. How important is it that we're positive when we're trying to get what we want?
Well, let me go back to your first question where you talked about change, and I actually deal with transformation. So change can be topical, epidermis level, visual level, while transformation, you have to go to the root of people's underlying belief systems. And when you get to the belief systems, that is our human thoughtware. When you get to belief systems, then transformation can occur. And the time is calling, not just for change, actually. We've had decades to just change. 2020 ushered us into transitioning into transformation. And so that's what I am all about in my body of work, whether it's my my national books or whether it's retreats, my courses, my programs, my coaching, and no matter what arena of my business, it's all about transformation and introducing people and ushering them into new paradigms, because new paradigms live in new belief systems and elevated belief systems. So yes, that's what I am all about. And then of course, as you know, because I work with a lot of women, I talk about this concept of radiance, that when we have done our healing work, when we have elevated to beliefs that give us expansiveness and spaciousness and room for full self-expression, that a luminosity starts to emit from us that we call radiance. Or, you know, when you look at pictures of the saints and the halo over their head is really representing that radiance being turned on. So I just wanted to address that first question. I'm about transformation. Change can reverse. Transformation, can't go from caterpillar to butterfly and back to caterpillar. You don't reverse with transformation.
I love it, love it, love it. And that's why this work that we're doing is about getting to the root cause, and we're having these deeper conversations, and we're creating a safe space for people to actually be able to spend some time with you. And we can't go into that in this conversation, but there needs to be work around healing, right? That, you know, you heard Dr. Beverly Yates, you heard Dr. Irene talk about the trauma that exists. We are traumatized, right? Right. I like to play videos from what's the lady's name? Forgot her name. Stories We Own, We Get to Write the Ending. Oh, Brene Brown. Stories We Own, We Get to Write the Ending, and Stories We Don't Own, Own Us. And when she talks about transformation, it's really about how do we really think about things differently and go deeper. So I love that. So Ms. Sabrina, what else can you tell us about this idea of radiance? Why is it important? I mean, we're doing this work, you know, this was about resilience and radiance, right? Resilience, doing the work, continuing to try to drive change and to do transformation, the right deep transformation, but also doing it with the level of joy and flow. Why is it so important that we activate, you know, not stressed out and raggedy, but actually do it in a way that it's coming from love and positive energy, attracting what we want?
Well, I have so enjoyed these comments that the other esteemed panelists have been making. And what's probably a little bit different about the perspective I bring is I do a lot of work with individuals, and I have my own company, so I'm not inside a corporate setting. And so I see the power of when individuals transform, and that's really the unit of focus that my business is in. Now it happens collectively and in cohort groups, but it really is directed at healing the individual. And to me, that, you know, and I'm really excited to see more conversation about healing, because for me, the point we're at as a country, it cannot occur without healing occurring. Healing cannot occur without forgiveness work. It is not possible, because trauma locks low-level emotions into our bodies. And one of the powerful ways that you release and transmute that energy that, for example, Dr. Irene was talking about is forgiveness work. And it's not a religious term. It is a human thing. And we're awkward around it because we're materialism-based ideology. So valuing something like healing and forgiveness work, we may talk about it, but we're real awkward when it comes to, well, what does that really mean? And so in every course I do, I include forgiveness work so that we can transform that low-level emotion up to a higher vibration emotion. And when you do that, you start to have a luminosity in the radiance, and radiance is a power and a force and a resource. So that's what's so exciting is, and you know, and I wouldn't say that trauma affects this maybe at the DNA level, I would say cellular level, and cells hold memory, and the trauma linked to the memory can be discharged. That's the great news. And yeah. When you are coming from that place of now being free, then you show up in the world differently. You can bring your voice forward like Kay does in her hair salon versus stifling and suppressing your voice or diminishing your perceived value around the conference room table, etc. So there's just linkages to so much of what everybody has talked about. And, you know, at, for example, with women, we have socially, not only sometimes in our families, but also socially on the larger level, we have stifled and suppressed our voice. And so when you start to do that transformation work and the beliefs that have you stifling and suppressing it are cleared and replaced, then you come forward as a voice and recognizing you have a voice. And so I've just seen, you know, the power of radiant women and the forces for positive change from a place of love and being healed and discharging the trauma. Which is really just a certain set of emotions and beliefs and thoughts. So yes, let's make more radiant women in the world.
I love it. There's so much that you and I can discuss. There's a lot. And I know you have to drop. Also, you came in at 11 o'clock. You have to drop at 11:20. So we have 7 minutes left with you. I'm going to ask you one last question. If you had to look in the camera and speak to someone who did not believe that there was any equity, racial issues to address in corporate America, you're talking to Satya Nadella, you're talking to, you know, executives and CEOs in a corporate space, you're talking to business owners and business leaders like Kay, who, you know, they don't realize that there's a problem even to solve. And you do work with individuals, and so do we. Like, part of this work, it's called the Bigger Than Me Success Series. It's all of us together, but it's about these individual transformations, these individual connections. So what would you say as a master life coach, as someone who's been doing this work, 3 nationally best-selling books, all about transformation, how do you help someone who doesn't know they need to be helped?
Well, it's very simple. I, for 9 years, was on the board of trustees for a college here in Washington State, and we were the award-winningest higher ed institution in the state when it came to diversity. And one of the things that we did is we didn't just convene faculty and staff to talk about diversity. We talked to the students. It's really simple. What's your experience here? We're making this way too complicated. You just get the students together and say, so what's your experience here? And then you listen and you validate what they're saying versus arguing or dismissing or rationalizing. And it's very, very simple. So we're a culture that's so good at rationalizing and dismissing based upon the hierarchy that we've established in the past. Let's create a new future with our language. And So same thing with employees. You know, you want to know what's experience of women or what's experience of African-Americans in your company, you get them together and you say, now listen, this is not where you get to keep censoring your conversation. This is where you get to be truthful. You have to tell them that so they know there will not be a consequence for truthful speaking, because there has been. And then you listen and you ask great questions, and then you have a commitment to act on what is shared, and it's very simple. And then the solutions also reside in the wisdom of those sharing with you. So you don't have to go hire $50,000 an hour consultants to put plans together. Those same people will be able to tell you exactly what would change the vibe, the feel, the culture. And we don't do that enough. We've made it way too complicated. You don't need all these task forces every time. I mean, it's amazing how easily we can complicate stuff in our culture.
I love that. What I love about what you just shared is that's part of this ongoing conversation. And so as we continue to move this work forward, part of it is, and then again, where's Pam? Pam actually just shared some research that says less than 8 to 10% of Black people are actually comfortable telling the truth in corporate America. So I love that you just said, emphasize that there will not be any consequences. Now, that may or may not convince someone that they could still be honest, but you may get a little bit more information. The reason we're doing this Bigger Than Me success series, the reason we have faces and voices that are being truly transformative around all type of different industries, is because we want people to see this is a microcosm of what's happening in your company. To assume that what we're saying is true, share these videos with someone and see, they'll probably nod their head and say, yeah, that's true. But for people to really come up with their own, you know, share their own truths, believing, risk wanting to risk their jobs. Oftentimes in corporate America, research for decades has said that we don't. That's why we still have, you know, these challenges that have persisted for decades. Is there anything, final thing that you want to share with a, you're looking out into the eyes of a corporate executive in your last 3 minutes with us, and you're talking to a business owner, what would you say to them about their account of personal responsibility to drive change?
Well, everyone that is on this panel is highly, highly self-aware and reflective, which is so refreshing. But particularly when you are leading an organization, you set the water level, you set the expectation level, you actually set energetically and on the invisible level what the rest of the organization responds to. So it isn't just what you say and what you wrote in an initiative or a statement to the organization. It also has to do with the level of your own beliefs. And so for us to continue to be rigorously self-reflective and rigorously challenging as leaders is so critical, because that will keep the water level raising. That gives space for others to raise up into a higher level of accountability, truth-telling, self-reflection. And that's how change happens. It's me plus you plus. That's how change happens. It's individuals changing and moving, hopefully at some level of orchestration and synchronicity. And that's how you have cultural change. So let's not forget the building block of change is each individual person. So being sure we continue to stretch ourselves and illuminate our own blind spots. And that is a huge and honorable task.
Oh, Irene, I love you. I need you to know that.
Back at you.
Can you do me a favor real quick? I actually participated in your Juicy Woman University over the last year. And I think we talk about resilience and radiance, which means, you know, giving women and, you know, an outlet to change their status quo. So would you like to just take a moment to tell people, I know you have another community of JWU happening right now. Would you like to tell people about what it is and how they can find you?
Yes. Well, 3 years ago, I launched a flagship 12-month life transformation program. And, you know, to shift people out of the what I call the reboot, R-E-B-O-O life that the American ideology and culture gives us, ripping and running, efforting, busyness, overwhelm and overdoing, reboot is the norm. It's reinforced. It starts to be installed as a value and belief system for women right around age 3 and 4, my research has shown. And so to move women into this elevated realm of existing that I call the sacred self-caring consciousness and living as a juicy woman, there's a lot of stuff to unlearn and a lot of entrenched and entrained neural pathways to disconnect and reset a new pattern. And it's done in a cohort community, which is very powerful and synergistic. But it's a space and a place for me to move a group of ready women that really want to elevate to a new paradigm for living as a woman. And that's really kind of the crucible in the container for mentoring, coaching, and guiding women into, or I should say into, it's really up to this new level of existence so that they can experience what I call it, the juicy woman lifestyle, which is characterized by more ease and flow and radiance, deeper spiritual connection, joy, order, beauty, aligning their lives with their feminine essence, because we've learned how to align it with masculine ways of being, which in certain spaces and places work and are yet useful, but we're bringing that into spaces where it's creating chaos and breakdown. And so reminding women of how to return to their natural and divinely designed essence so that they can stop straining their spirit and stressing out their mind, body, and spirit. So that's what Juicy Woman University is all about. And yes, enrollment only opens once a year and it's going on right now. $1,000,000mentor.net, $1,000,000mentor.net is my online presence, and all the information is there for Juicy Woman University, my books that you mentioned, other courses and programs and self-study courses, all kinds of good stuff is all available at $1,000,000mentor.net. And we're glad to have you coming back for another year. Half of every year's class, which just blows my mind, after a 12-month program, half of every year's class returns and re-enrolls. So it's that powerful, and it's about transformation, not just change. So thank you for having me, and thank you to all of you for your great work and your sharing this morning. Thank you, Traci, for doing this.
Thank you. This is my life's work, and what's exciting about what we're doing is the next phase of this work is we are creating creating this bigger than me movement, right? The work we've been doing for a year, it's been 6 months focused specifically around achieving racial equity and inclusion, but we're gonna transition that into an online ecosystem where everything's free. Like, we're gonna make sure everyone has access. You can buy into some other things like masterminds with people like Debrina, who this is her job, and masterminds, right, to elevate your conversation. But we need to make sure that people get all these webinars. That's why I do them all for free, because it has to be changing the status quo, changing it for everyone, really transforming, giving you a space that you can be, you know, around loving individuals. So we're going to do very much what you said, right? These principles around, for bigger than me, is around positive psychology, this idea of adaptive leadership, self-directed learning, which is the idea of communities, and then growth mindset and action. So that's really what we're going to continue to do, is take these webinars and move them into a point of activation and invite people like you, honestly, to take the rest of us on a journey that includes things like, you know, healing. You know, healing, we're bringing Dr. Irene back and have someone who's committed to do some rapid transformational therapy for us as a group to have people think through. So there's a lot of work that really needs to happen. So I love that you said, and I love that Lennox mentioned, you know what, we can't just be about one thing. It has to be about true, deep transformation. That means we transform as individuals, and then the systems change. So thank you, Debrina. Thank you so much. I'm so grateful for you and everyone else that's here. So Debrina mentioned the term juicy woman, and the word juicy, you saw she described it, right? You're not ripping and running. You're in the flow. You know, you're connected to your, divine mission. And so the next woman I'm going to bring up is a juicy woman. Jonni Reddick, how are you? How are you, Jonni? I'm going to remove my spotlight. So it's
okay.
Just
okay. Well, all right. Thanks for that kind of intro there, Traci.
So wait. So I met Jonni with Dr. Irene and Dr. Beverly Yates. We actually all met through Loni. right?
Bonnie, yeah.
Bonnie as well. We all met through this Beyond TV boot camp. We all met through Chris Whitfield and Jen Gottlieb. And one thing I loved about you is that you have an amazing story. We're talking about racial equity and inclusion. So oftentimes, you know, you're mixed. You also said you have heritage of both sides. Sometimes we have Black people on this call. And I'm like, we can't be talking to ourselves. So I like to bring in these white leaders and white executives, but you have the blue, the Black and the white. So you're Black, white, and blue. Tell us a little bit about that.
Yes. Thank you. And for those of you, I'll reintroduce myself. I'm Jonni Reddick, and I'm retired 29 years from a large state police agency here in California. When I retired as an executive level, as an assistant chief, which is the top 1% of my organization, but also all of policing in the country. And so when we were having this conversation, Traci, it was around what I do now in consulting, which is, you know, leadership development. And I work with police agencies in their succession planning and promotional readiness and their organizational culture. And you tapped into my vulnerability because I was talking more about the business versus talking about myself. And when we did that, we got into a discussion about this real space of, Black Lives Matter and Blue Lives Matter, right? Which is in this national dialogue. And I have a Black family, I'm a Black person, and I work in an organization where if you look politically down the lines, there's more red than blue. And if you look at research, even Pew Research within law enforcement agencies, Black officers and white officers do not see the same on how what equity and inclusion looks like. Those numbers are very skewed. And so you have this internal issue at all levels. And I love this discussion about leadership, taking the reins and doing something with it. But if we don't, so I'm sitting here looking at this panel of brilliant people talking about a brilliant discussion, but how is that discussion had when you go back to an organization for them to be able to understand and tap into the sensitivity of the conversation, allowing themselves to be vulnerable, maybe identifying, like we've said, blind spots or biases, but we don't do that. We try to provide a training, and the training that we give doesn't do the deep work that we're talking about, whether it's Dr. Irene's DNA to the DNA level, or Debrina's talking about the cell level of the memory of the trauma or the impact or the misunderstanding or understanding. And so one of the things I had shared with you is coming up through the organization, it's predominantly male and white male. That is just the facts. So it's not like I'm, having an opinion. And so coming up, whether you're, Black or you're another minority group or female, it's very tough. It's policing. And what I found, though, was the silos of the very thing you're talking about of being not included. And it got to be to the point where you became the person where people were coming to how do I prepare for an exam? How do I move up into a position? And it becomes difficult in an organization if you're only one of two or three, or you're less than so many percent in a large organization to create what they can see themselves doing, right? So that's where this conversation needs to expand itself organizationally. But the work I also do is I have been a member for 2 decades of the National Organization of Black Law Enforcement Executives. And I was our local chapter president here for a while, but that work is bridging this community conversation with policing, but we also work at injustice and inequities. And in that work, we also work to mentor and develop leadership in the organization. And that's from, our rank and file all the way through. And then the bigger piece is getting the community to understand policing in a way where we can have some empathy on that side as well. And then for our officers to be able to do that in so many capacities, because the bottom line is when you sign up for policing, you are tapping into what should be a calling, and it's a service above self, it magnified and amplified. And so what we find is not what I call the ability to have conflict resolution, but to engage in real good conversations that create the vulnerability and the transformational change that has been echoed throughout this panel. So I really appreciate you extending the offer for me to come on here, because again, I do a complex things, whether I'm teaching, consulting, or I'm working with nonprofits and in the community. But I love being a part of this conversation, and I do hope you do invite me back.
You are in. Listen, you all are officially family. It's going to take a lot for you to get rid of me now, just so that we're on the same page. Miss Loni, how are you? Another one of my Be On TV family. How are you?
I'm good. Thank you for having me.
Thank you. And I see you have your handsome husband next to you. What is his name?
Hey, everyone. I'm Jammin.
Jammin, how are you? So, Loni, first of all, can you introduce yourself? Tell us who you are. And what I thought was so interesting, and again, guys, these are around this session is around having real courageous conversations. Real conversations that allow us to drive change. And you told me about something. Tell us who you are, what you do, and an experience that you and your husband had that basically perfectly aligns with this conversation.
Sure. So I'm the founder and CEO of Entirely Eco. It's an online store. So I sell sustainable, organic home decor products. So good for people, good for the environment. And really, what's top of mind for me right now in the conversations that I'm having is, as marketers, especially owners of stores and e-commerce stores and even brick and mortar stores, as we're marketing, we have to be more conscious and more intentional about the way in which we are marketing. And, you know, recently there was a popular clothing line, and they, every time around this year, they do holiday pajamas for the families. And they share all of these pictures on their website and on their social media about all of these families wearing pajamas. Well, this year there was an African-American family that was featured, and it was a mom and two kids, and the dad wasn't there. And what happened was the dad had a conflict and couldn't be at the photo shoot, so they just went on with the photo shoot. But what the message and why so many people took offense to it is, you have all these other families, Asian families, white families, and they all are full families. And then you see this African-American family and the dad is missing. Now, it wasn't intentional. The dad just couldn't make the photo shoot, so they went along with it. But the message that it sent was, Black families don't have dads. And people were really upset about it. And the company came out and, you know, apologized and didn't realize, you know, the families weren't grouped together. So they were isolated, you know, things, but people can see it. And people were really upset about it. And so it's important that, even if this wasn't the intention, that we look at how can our marketing be perceived and how can this impact people and make people feel. I have a friend who has a clothing line, and it's for kids, and she's been wanting to make a conscious effort about, you know, including more diversity in her catalogs and her social media pictures that are featuring her clothing. And so she has a family who are real customers, and the mom is a photographer. And the mom said, oh, I'm going to take some pictures of my kids and the clothing, and then you can use it in your marketing. And so the mom took pictures, and they live in the Midwest somewhere. So they took pictures outside, and the pictures were beautiful. And as they were viewing the pictures to like release them, you know, in marketing materials, she has an African-American employee who saw the pictures and said, you cannot post these pictures. You cannot send these pictures out. And she said, oh, why not? You know, they're beautiful. The kids are gorgeous. You know, it features the clothing well. And he said, and the kid, you know, they are dark complexion, African-American, and really natural hair. And the brand is very moody. So not a lot of smiling in place. So it's very moody. Well, what it looks like based on how the outfits looked, it looked like the kids were out in cotton fields, like picking cotton. And he had a response to seeing this picture because it reminded him of slavery. And he said, you cannot, you know, post these pictures. The good thing is she has employees in the companies that are like diverse and represent these different perspectives, because when she looked at the picture, her being white, she didn't have that reaction, but he did. And so they got in front of it and didn't release those pictures, and, you know, had some ones that didn't put out that type of response to give people that feeling. But this is why it's important that in our marketing departments that we have people from diverse backgrounds and perspectives so that they can give us these insights before we put something out there that's going to hurt people and make people feel a kind of way. And so, and even in my own marketing, you know, I sell certified organic cotton bedding. And so I was thinking of doing a photo shoot and I picked up this because it is natural. And I'm like, oh my gosh, it's cotton. I could place this next to, you know, some of the blankets and the pillows that I sell. And I had this on the counter and my husband came in and was like, what is that? He had this reaction to this. And he said, what did you get? Go in the fields and cotton pick? Like, what is this? And I said, it's the same thing. And here I am, you know, I have the same experience. And so now I'm really passionate about making sure that marketers, you know, are conscious and intentional about what they're putting out there. So I'll let my husband, you know, introduce himself and talk about his.
The reason that is, Loni told us this story with Jonni and myself and Dr. Irene in a call. And I thought, oh my God, that's so awesome. Can you get your husband? So I need you to scoot yourself on in here to get centered. You had a physical reaction to this cotton. Tell us about that. What was that?
Well, yeah,
who are you, first of all, and what was that?
Yeah. Thank you guys for having me. So I'm Jamin Brown. I'm just for background, I'm an executive at a aerospace and defense company. And you know, we have these conversations very regularly. You know, so I really am just excited about what you guys are doing. The fact that you've invited me to be a part of this, I think this is great.
Can you speak a little bit louder for us?
So
thank you.
When I got home and I saw this cotton sitting on the counter, it was just it was out of place. Two, I've never personally had that experience, but I was really resonating with today what Dr. Irene said, what others have said about, you know, the idea that it's at a cellular level, right? I had this immediate physiological reaction to seeing this thing on the table. I also shared with Loni, you know, so we have facilities all over the country, and there is a facility that's in Alabama, and we have to drive past a series of cotton fields. And I have this negative emotional reaction every time I have to drive through it. You know, so it's really resonating with me, this idea of it's cellular, it's passed down. And we all have to be very mindful as we enter this space, whether it's marketing, whether it's the visuals that we put up to have these discussions in our executive spaces.
Thank you so much. What I also think is important, you know, for us to have in this conversation is also this idea when we talk about corporate chokeholds. Again, I use that term specifically because we, you know, there is a trauma that has occurred. And when it happens, you know, like you said, being able to think about a higher level of sensitivity, a higher level of urgency around work that's happening when you have employees that might be under constant stress, that might be under a different level of, I'll say, intense trauma, you know, there's an opportunity for us to really think about this differently. So I'm excited that you both were able to share that. If you're able to stay on to the next phase of our conversation, I'd love it. I can't believe we only have 20 minutes left in this first conversation. I know most of you are probably gonna have to drop, but I know we're gonna continue the conversation to the second half because there's so many other stories I wanna highlight. So next we have Mr. Andy Wappler, another individual who's been a part of this for quite a while. Andy, would you like to introduce yourself and tell us who you are? Let me remove my spotlight and just spotlight you. Tell us who you are. And Andy, you've been doing some great work with Tabor 100, a group that you and I and Patricia are also a part of. Tell us about this Black Equity Fund that you're leading, but also the work that's about how we move beyond companies doing the easy work. Like you know, when Microsoft first announced we're going to hire 50% more Black people, I like cringed. I had a visceral response. Like, oh my God, no. Like you can't just focus on hiring. Like that's going to lead us to, you know, a place of increased trauma. Again, I sat across from people who were traumatized. I have my own experience, right? The last three presidents of the National Black MBA will tell you there's some other work that needs to happen from a cultural perspective, systemic work. So Andy, tell us, why is it so important that you do the work you're doing, and why is it important that you keep pushing people to even go beyond what seems like the easy work of hiring and donating money? Although that's good work, but why do we need more?
Yeah, for sure. And good morning, everybody. And thanks. It's always it's really great listening in. It's always inspiring. I appreciate that. And My personal Radiance Award winner for today is Traci. She's always just glowing and so enthusiastic and just always great to be in her presence. I work for the electric and gas utility here for Western Washington. And before that, I worked for a long time in TV in the area. So I'm a communications person really by trade and by passion. And I also really am interested in just corporate change. And a couple of things that really struck me here this morning. One, I think that idea of the self and having to have that self be out there to evangelize for the change. I think that's incredibly important. Also saw the comment from Bill Wells talking about the complexity. And I think that's really the issue. I really believe in when people have said here this morning, let's not overcomplicate this. And I take that for myself as being the conversation on the cotton to me is a good example. I can't understand that visceral feeling, but I'll believe you if you say you have it. And I can't understand it because I just don't have all that experience. And I'll tell you as a trivial example, I used to be a meteorologist. I now work for the electric company. It makes me really nervous and really uncomfortable when the wind blows, because when the wind blows at my life, it's not a good thing. It hasn't been a good thing for a long time. It means there's a storm, whatever. Trivial example, but that's something where most people be like, why does it make you anxious when the wind blows? In my line of work, believe me, it does. So I kind of take it from there of when people look at things like the cotton, I thought it was a nice visual too. And I totally get it why it's not. So to me, I don't want to make these things too complicated. I think we have a tendency to want too much data and too much other things. If you tell me this is your experience, I'm just going to believe you. Now, when it gets to changing the corporations, I do think, as Bill Wells said, that gets very complicated. And to me, the key, when I'm trying to drive inside of my company today, is we have an executive, our executive who's in charge of human resources, a Black woman. She is leading our diversity efforts, as well as a whole lot of other people efforts. But it can't just be your diversity department's effort. It has to be a whole lot of other people. And that is exactly like every other change inside of a company. I have the customer service function of my company. I couldn't improve our customer service by myself. I needed all the operations people to understand why it mattered. I needed finance to understand why it mattered. I needed our regulatory and government relations people. People who said, I don't serve customers. Why should I be in the customer service? Why does that matter to me? I needed them to understand how their success and the company's success depended upon this, even though their business card didn't say customer service anywhere on it. And that complexity is a real challenge inside of companies. That's why I think if you're inside of a company and like me, it's not in my job description, except my job description is to advance the company as an executive. And I think we have to solve this as a company. I think we have to solve it as a society. But to me, it's that kind of weird paradox of let's keep it simple enough that we can be actionable and that we can evangelize for it. At the same time, be really aware of the complexity and the breadth of what it takes to move things. And it's kind of finding that center point in an organization. Really simple, clear message that people can go, I can get behind that personally because they need to. At the same time, really looking and not being blind to the fact that a whole lot of things will have to change to make it really different inside a company. And I think last time Traci mentioned something that was really a light bulb for me. It's one thing to bring people in and have diverse hiring. It's a totally different thing to have people want to stick and stay and feel they can advance. So this has been very helpful for me to think about that. And at last, I'll give a plug for the thing I've been working on with Patricia and others. Tabor 100, if you're around the Seattle area, you may know of it. It is a Black business group, kind of a chamber of commerce, so to speak, designed to help advance Black businesses. And a number of us were asked by the president to come forward and say, hey, could you help with a fund? And we have a Black Business Equity Fund. We've raised $1.5 million for Tabor here the last few months. We'd like to raise more. And our goal is to provide more resources to go in grants for Black businesses affected by the pandemic, as well as just other issues in society, to improve the capacity of the Tabor group, and to provide greater vehicles so that if you are Black and you are starting a business or you have one that's going and you need some sort of assistance, a venue so that, hey, you are I don't know, you got a great idea for a clothing line, but you don't know websites. You can get in touch with somebody at a company around here that knows websites. You can just coach you and help you. So that effort, I think, has been fantastic. Last part of that, the employers here in the area, the big ones, all came out with a big statement recently on racial equity. It's great. They're committed to trying to really advance things. They're committing $2 billion towards this effort. Fantastic. I want to take their commitment with the promise of what Tabor can actually do and put it together. And really, in addition to the funding, have those rich conversations that enable people to feel, yeah, I can actually play a part in this and make a difference. So that's my spiel. I'm excited to be here. I love every time when I come. I hear and I learn new things, and I really appreciate the perspectives. Thank you.
I love it. So Andy, real quick, before I let you go, this is called the Bigger Than Me Success Series. And at one point we were having a session and you said, you went the opposite way. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
No, it's I call it the All About Me Success Series. And I say that because of this. I believe that things are additive. I believe that my life is improved when other lives are improved. And I think one of the places that people go that reinforces maybe their racism, their bigotry, their refusal to change is they believe it is a zero-sum society. I do not. And so if I have a place where I want to try and be radiant, it's around that point. I believe that when my neighbors do better, I do better. And I just think that people need to understand, I believe every white person has a lot of self-interest in making Black people's lives better. I think all of us have a lot of self-interest in making other people's lives better. So yes, there's my It's All About Me Success Series, because I just think when other people, I think when my neighbors are doing well, I think I do well. And that to me is, I see where connection has popped up from Dr. Irene. Yeah, it's about connections. And if you think you're alone and other people's failures won't affect you, no, when other people are not doing well, it comes back around to you.
I love that. Oh my God, you guys are also amazing. And I cannot honestly believe that we only have 15 minutes left, less than 15 minutes left. So I'm gonna get through this. And then we are gonna have an extended session for anyone who wants to say. I am gonna officially end the call on time. And then we're going to continue this conversation for anyone who wants to say. So next is one of my favorite people. I have to find her, Amelia. There you are, Amelia Jackson. Amelia, you are officially spotlighted. Can you tell us who you are, Amelia? And then you and I are both presidents of the National Black MBA Association. I'm president of the Seattle chapter. You're president of the Chicago chapter. And when I tell my personal story, I want you to spotlight us together here for a second. So when I tell my personal story, I actually like to say, if I wasn't president of the National Black MBA Association, I would have had a different level of personal accountability, right, in this work around equity and inclusion, because part of what we do is we bring people from, for example, the East Coast to the West Coast. That was my journey, right? And if you bring someone from the East Coast to the West Coast, knowing that your experience was less than optimal, right? Mm-hmm. So then there's a little something that there's some accountability there that I actually felt like a slave ship driver. Like I love, I can't be just, oblivious and, oh, I love driving boats. Not realizing that, if I'm bringing people to a place that is less than optimal, then I have some accountability to where I'm taking them, right? And so I hate to say it like that, but, so I lovingly started to do this work internally in corporate America. And then I realized it was like, it's better to be done outside of an organization than inside. Because at one point I was like the patient laying on an operating table, telling the surgeon how to remove my appendix. That is a non-tenable situation, right? So tell me, as the president of a national organization whose responsibility is around equity and inclusion, we talk about diversity hiring a lot, what would you say to corporate executives about why it's so important that we focus on retention? That it's not about hiring people, bringing them in, traumatizing them, cycling them through, but really about lovingly creating a safe space for everyone to grow. Because my problem was, I believe they actually want it. That's why we're doing this work with the principles around positive psychology. I believe they want it. We have a process for them to get it. What would you say to people about really focusing on not just hiring, but really retention?
Three words: diversity of thought. Diversity of thought. You can't have a profitable business that is going to excel both nationally or globally if you don't have the right people set in place representing your organization that can help it grow. And those right, the right people are not going to look the same. Those people are not going to think the same. You don't want to have group thought if you're trying to grow in your organization. If you're trying to be a profitable business, it's not going to happen. So at our level in the National Black MBA Association, the Chicago chapter, and Seattle chapter, and all the chapters that are represented on here, especially Bill Wells with the Twin City chapters of Minnesota, we, our job is to help facilitate opportunities for corporations to come to us to get to that diverse talent. But then we also encourage through our programming that that diverse talent should be embraced, not just culturally, but have equitable opportunities within the company to really be included in the decision-making processes so that you in fact do have that growth strategy for gaining more profits for your organization. If the color that you should see, the only color institutions should see is green. That's the only color. Anybody who is able to get you to that color, whether white, black, Latino, Asian, LGBT, Native American, whoever you have, those individuals should be able to get you to that color because they have the forethought, they have the insight on how to do it. So it is our job to help create programming that's gonna facilitate those opportunities. And to also get corporations to understand, going back to what Andy said, it's more than just recruiting. You can recruit all day. If you don't have a culture that is going to sustain those individuals, you're going to lose that diversity of thought. So it's all about retention. It really is about retention. So I say that, did someone want to add to that? Tracy, did you want to add to that?
I think you're amazing. I cannot believe that we are this short on time. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to move to the next person. Each person at the end, after we're going to have Patricia do her quick intro and her key point. I'm going to go to Albert. Then I'm going to come back and we're going to do a rapid fire session with each of you. And I'm going to ask each of you to identify what is that one thing that you want our listeners to hear from you as far as action is concerned. What is that one takeaway that you want to put into the universe as relates to driving real action? And then for the attendees, feel free to continue to share your comments. For the second session, we're gonna actually be able to bring some of you in if you're interested, and we're just gonna continue to record, and I have some other individuals. Some of these guys have some other great stories. I know, Bill, I'm gonna come to you as soon as we end because I want you to tell us what you're talking about, and then I'm gonna cycle around and see if there's any longer thing that each person wants to share, but we're gonna try to end on time with the quickest thing that you can share. Does that work? All right, Patricia, one of my favorite people, coming to you real quick. Now, we started having a conversation around courageous conversations. Thank you, Amelia. We started having conversations around courageous conversations, and I want you to give me the short version of one of the courageous conversations that you had with your friends around your personal transformation. You mentioned that, you know, you used to stuff things until George Floyd, and now you kind of had a different pace in your head. Tell us about that.
Okay, thank you all. I'm Patricia Davis with DeMarsh Consulting. We focus on business process improvement, diversity, equity, and inclusion training, and remote work strategy. So yes, Tracy and I were talking about a friend of mine, and she has been my friend for probably 25 years, a white woman. And if you ask her, she will tell you that she's the reason I got the job when we first met. Well, no, she wasn't the reason I got the job when we first met. It was what I brought to the company that got me the job. She only poked at the manager to make that final decision. Anyway, we just had a recent conversation. Actually, let me take a step back. So throughout my 25-year relationship with my friend, she would constantly pat me on the head like I was a puppy. And I've always had like a reaction to it, sort of stuffed down deep. And I never said anything to her about it and how it made me feel. And she would constantly say things to me like, well, you know, you're not Black. You're not really Black. And it's like, well yes, I am. I might be biracial, but I am certainly a Black woman. And we recently had a conversation because she asked me to pick her up from the airport on Christmas, which I sort of reluctantly agreed to do. But during this conversation, she said, I felt brave enough because she voted for Obama 2 times. And then she voted for Donald Trump 2 times. And so I asked her how she felt about what was going on with the elections this year. And she's completely drunk the Kool-Aid. She's like, well, you know, the election was stolen and you know, there was just so many.
Now, typically we don't talk politics. We don't really talk politics. Right. Bigger than me. Nobody's red, nobody's blue. This is the party of purple here. So we don't care. We don't care about any political affiliations, but any other thing you want to share about the courageous conversation about how you felt or anything else non-political, if you don't mind.
Yeah, no problem. I'm sorry, I'm making this too long. No, anyway, I finally told her that it was not appropriate for her to touch my hair because I had reached out and touched hers and she had this reaction. And I told her, that's my reaction. And, you know, she immediately starts crying. And it's like, why are you crying? I'm the one that should be crying. I've been offended all these years. Anyway, so I love that.
I just love that
because I didn't want to offend her, but it's like it's not okay for you to offend me.
I love that. So we were having this conversation recently with you and Rachel and someone else, and this idea of touching a Black woman's hair. I'm going to actually show the gallery. Is there anybody who is down with someone touching your hair? Any Black woman on this call? Is it a problem for you? Raise your hand if it's a problem. If someone touches your hair, let's get that courageous conversation out there into the universe. So anyway, I just thought it was hilarious that when she touched that woman's hair, she cried. Come on. Yeah. But what I love about that is, and then we had a conversation about tears, right? And what I love about this is the truth is, I bet she cried because she felt uncomfortable. She didn't want to harm you. She didn't want to hurt you. So I have to always assume the best of people. So we're going to have a different conversation and go deeper about tears and about the process and what you do with real courageous conversations. We'll come back to that. But I just appreciate you because I think we have to prepare people for what courageous conversations may end up with, how they may result. And they may result with someone crying and they may result with someone, you know, feeling uncomfortable and all that good stuff. So real quick, Albert, I cannot believe we're 3 minutes left. Albert, be quick as you possibly can. What can you tell us about who you are and this idea of, what advice would you share about this idea of transformation, like individual transformation and being the best we can be? Why is that so important?
Definitely. My name is Albert Urena. I'm originally from the Dominican Republic. I'm an international bestselling author with Traci. We contributed in a compilation book. Basically, as Debrina said, transformation is individual. It has to start with the individual person. Bill mentioned that change is not going to be a one and done thing, and I totally agree with that. We have to create a safe space for our Black brothers and sisters, for them to be able to share with transparency and how they truly feel, a safe space of no judgment, no repercussions, and unconditional love. I believe that humanity is going through a beautiful time in age where we are moving from an ethnocentric point of view, the mentality that says us versus them, you know, you're Black, I'm white, I'm brown, into a world-centrism point of view, which says we are one human race. And I want to honor the life of George Floyd because his death had a divine purpose. It ignited this important conversation that we have to have as a society. And just it starts with you. It starts with each individual realizing and gaining the awareness that we are one human race, that we are not the color of our skin. We are at a deeper level. We are a soul. We are all humans. So I'm just grateful to be in this panel with all of you. I learned a lot today. And Traci, thank you so much for the invitation because my life purpose is unity. I share the same dream as Dr. Martin Luther King. I call it the dream part 2. My dream is to see humanity as one, loving one another as one. We need to stop the killing.
Oh, I love that. Thank you so very much. So we have a gallery view now. All of our amazing people should be here. Lennox, I'm gonna go to you first. Can you tell us, Lennox, what is the one thing, this is the wrap up, what is the one call to action, the one thing that you would share with the listening audience and those who are gonna be watching this video and the compilation that we're pulling together, what is that one thing that you would share moving forward about what people can do to truly drive change? What do you want people to hear from you, to know from you?
Well, Reggie kind of brought it up in the beginning that America has been out of integrity with the Constitution of the United States. And now with the inflection point from the George Floyd death, society is open. The awareness level is there. The conversations are happening that all citizens can own what happened in the past and figure out solutions for inclusion. And it's not for a 30-year situation, even though there's items in quality education to lead to greater things down the road, but it's also to intentionally be an invitation for inclusion today, create those positions or those situations for education, for advancement, leadership items and things like that at this time.
Love it. Love it. Thank you so much. Rex, coming to you next. What would you share as your final message?
I think what I would share with our audience today is think about everything that you've heard thus far from all the presenters and speakers, and some of the things you may have read in the chat box, and get a sense that, in fact, this is a really large, complicated thing to do. But as my dad used to tell us, you're not poor, lost lamb. There's a lot that you can do to evolve, transform the situation and the point in time that we find ourselves today. But you have to believe that you can do it. You have the power to change systems together with other people and approach to that. But you have to believe that before you can do it. So belief in self, belief that we are a good people and want to be even better, and you will achieve great things.
I love it. Dr. Beverly Yates, I'm going to pull you in. I see that you need to leave to go save some lives. Can you tell us what is your final, what would you like to share with people as your call to action?
Thank you so much for this invitation to be here today, Tracy, and these amazing people that we're here together with. You know, I've just loved everything about the conversation. So my take home action for people is this. If you find people in your corporation, your community, who are struggling with issues with diabetes and heart disease, know that chronic relentless stress has a huge impact on whether or not they have that problem. It will force it to be expressed. I talk about stress like a bully, slams you up against the vulnerabilities you may have in your genetic code. And next thing you know, you've got a problem. So with that in mind, please people, let's think about our impacts and behaviors in the world. And as a community, make that commitment to each other to lower the amounts of stress that we're under. When someone says to you that they're having a struggle, believe them. And if people are silent, know that they aren't feeling included. Do what you can to welcome them. It can have a bottom line impact on their health. Thank you all.
I love it. Thank you so much. Next call to action. Dr. Irene, what would you share? The call to action.
Thank you so much for having me here, Tracy, and the whole panel. I've enjoyed this tremendously. My one thing that I really want to leave you with is that we are only as strong as our weakest link. And this is definitely a weak link of society and humanity globally. It's not just an American problem, it's a Canadian problem everywhere in the world. And it requires a double-pronged approach. And I love what we've said about taking action. Awareness is key, it's 80% of the battle. And then from there, we need to take inspired action. So the challenge for all of the CEOs, the executives that are listening, it's understanding that you need to take action, create that safe space, as everyone has said. And then individually, knowing that we need to heal ourselves. and I include myself in that. I've been working on it. Heal ourselves from the trauma and adversity that we have experienced in our lives, from our generational trauma and from our epigenetic PTSD. And I'll leave you with one quote from Gandhi, who said, "If we could change ourselves, the tendency in the world would also change. As a man changes his own nature, so does the attitude of the world change towards him. We need not wait to see what others do." It all starts with us, whether we are the executives at the top of the companies or whether we're that one person feeling embattled.
I love it, love it, love it. Amelia, I see that you have to leave here momentarily. Let me jump to you, Amelia. I think she put that in already. Okay, perfect. Let me go to Bill. I think you're going to be next. I'm losing track of who I said, so we're going to go to Bill.
Okay. All right. Well, I actually, my call to action has shifted on me as I worked through today's session. Here's the deal. We are all influencers. I'm not sure that any one individual on today's call can do anything specifically to kind of stem the tide on this and get the ship moving in the right direction. However, here's my call to action, and it's coming back to you, Traci. I believe that the combined influence and power of the people that were on this panel today, as well as the participants that we can't really see, there's probably a large group of us, Pam McElvane included, and Pam gets it as well. We are practitioners, whether you have a specific title that calls you out as a diversity professional, or you just have the passion around the work, there's got to be a way that we can come together collectively to raise our voice. It's the same, it's a parallel type of approach that occurred with George Floyd's murder. I mean, that's a tragic incident that occurred, but now that there is attention on the issue, we need to capture our energy and focus on making as much change as possible while we can. Based on everything that I've witnessed throughout my career and not my life, I hate to say it, but these things come and go. And I think that for the moment now, many major corporations have made commitments to do something. They don't necessarily know what to do, but many of the same corporations have chief diversity officers or diversity leaders on staff. Many companies have been hiring them. We've seen them. If you get LinkedIn or any other BuzzFeed with news, you probably see people being appointed to leadership roles in diversity left and right. But that's not going to get the work done. The work's going to get done, and I've heard it today, at an individual level. The work that I do is, what I find is when I get hired to help develop a strategic D&I platform for the enterprise, much of my work winds up going into coaching for the CEO. And it's not even anything that's a part of the contract, but most CEOs, I'll say this and I'll be quiet. Now I'll move on so you can finish up. Most leaders are not willing to expose their lack of awareness or their ignorance. I think much about what Lennox said in his comments earlier today, and I'm totally with him. Many of them don't know, but they do know. What they know is they know what's right and they know what's wrong. So they may not understand all the ins and outs of diversity, equity, and inclusion. That's not necessary for them to run a business, because that's what they're charged to do. But they are also people in leadership that help set the moral compass of the organization. And so again, I'll just go back to, I think there's got to be a way, Traci, that we together come together as a group, and let's figure out what we're going to do as a group.
I love it. Love it. Loni, I think you're next.
Okay. Another quote by Gandhi I love is, be the change you wish to see in the world. No matter what level you are or what your platform is, you can make a difference. And it's not enough for you to just learn and understand be in this kind of group. You have to go out to other people and have these conversations and actually take action. So my call to action would be for everyone who's listening, tuned in today, that was inspired by something that was said today, go and have a courageous conversation this upcoming week with someone. Take that one little step of going out into your world and having and being vulnerable and being bold and have that courageous conversation. And that's what I want to share and leave with you. with you all today.
That is so beautiful. Thank you so much. After Loni, Jonni.
Yes, in closing, thank you again, everybody, and thank you, Traci. It's just going to pretty much echo what's already been said, but I truly believe that there's this great space for vulnerability, right? Because out of our vulnerability, we're going to have to face some of our own shame, some of our own guilt, some of that imposter syndrome that maybe we've carried around in our leadership or in our life. And we need to really think about how we can step outside of that so that we can then connect with others and not be defensive and be able to have some, I love the word, unarmored conversations. And I use the word armor because in policing, we go out and we wear a vest and we wear all of our things to be armored, but we're out there dealing with people. And it is a paradigm shift and a mindset, not only in policing and community, but for leaders. And I love what Bill was talking about and Lennox and this organizational culture that most of the time, and I think Pam echoed it in the comments, most of the time you're coaching leaders on these things, and that's the impact that you have on your people. And then they begin to model the behavior and that becomes the culture. And this is a beautiful time and a great beginning. I love this bigger than me. I love this bigger than me because together we can do something and I am all in. So I hope those listening want to participate and again, do their part.
Excellent. Thank you so much. Albert, what is your call to action? Well, you're talking to an executive right now. What would you tell them?
My call to action for an executive would be to become a better active listener. Create that safe space in your corporation, in your organization, where employees, especially Black brothers and sisters, are able to share transparency and just listen to understand. Because when we listen, we can relate better with other people. And that's what just people need, is to express how they really feel and not have that fear of being judged or being criticized. So just be a better active listener and forgive. We need to do a lot of forgiveness work to be able to move forward and create the transformation that we wish to create.
Oh, thank you so much. Albert, thank you. That was beautiful. Miss Patricia, what is your call to action?
My call to action is that we can explore how to build the capacity, ability, and bravery to understand each other and to be more open to other perspectives regarding racial equity.
Thank you so much. Andy, you always have something groundbreaking to share. What would you like to share? Setting up, you like those high expectations? What would you like to share as far as a call to action? You're talking to all those people who are giving millions of dollars. Remember how you and I said that we have to get people to think about truly changing the culture. How do you get people from writing checks to also actually investing in truly changing the culture so that lives are truly changed?
I just tell any business leader, this is a key business risk that you must address. Demographics are changing. Our country is changing. If you want the best talent, if you want to understand your customers, if you want to have messaging to them that resonates with all of them, you need to fix this. This is a business risk. Is if you just found out that your factory was built in a floodplain, you wouldn't leave it there, right? This is a risk to your business. Now, set aside everything else that we know is moral and right about it. If you're running a business and you don't address this risk, it's just like any other risk and you cannot let that go.
Wow. Love it. Love it. Love it. Love it. Okay. Cassandra, darling, what would you share as your final call to action?
You know, a couple of things, Traci. First, I just want to say thank you being amongst all these great experts on this call. This was amazing. I learn something every time. A couple of things. So think about, if I'm talking to a leader right now, I want you to think about the contrast of denial. The contrast of denial is confession, recognition, and acknowledgement. And those are from the famous, the wisdom of Dr. Ibram Kennedy, if you guys have read his book. I also want to add kind of what I said earlier, the deep introspection of ourselves and unpacking our own biases. And then last, which we really didn't get into, but we kind of touched on, we have to recognize and stop the policies and practices that lead to disparity and exclusion. Let me say that again. We have to stop supporting practices and policies that lead towards disparity and exclusion. That's in our communities and that's in our workforce.
Wow.
And that's it. Thank you.
Love it. Love it. Well, Pam, you know, last is not least. You guys are each equally amazing to me. I really do feel like I'm the luckiest woman in the world, to be perfectly honest. This is the work that I was meant to do. It's a work that I, you know, love to do. And I love connecting with each of you. So Ms. Pam, as a final call to action, what would you share? And again, this is about moving from a term that I created that you and I'm writing an article in your nationally published magazine about stop corporate chokeholds. What would you share with people about moving from having conversations to really taking truly transformative actions to truly change the status quo for generations to come? What would you say? What's your call to action?
Yeah, you know, yes, and yes, and, right? To include everything everyone said.
All of that, yes and yes. All,
right, and Traci, you mean you're modeling the action. And I'm going to give you something before I end. I'm going to give you a gift before I end here. So, okay, here's the call. Here you guys, here's a framework. Here's a framework. The president-elect coming in within less than 2 months by way of an appointment diversified the sub-cabinet. And then with a little push to remind him of the accountability, diversifying the cabinet. So that the people that trusted him, as our leaders would say, the folks that believed in him, made the action. So why can't you, in a role of influence, right, Lennox, make that change? Why can't you, in a role of where right next to you, one next to you, have that conversation? That's simple. If the highest officer in the land can by appointment begin to still have first today, you can still decide what your first will be. And because of the doctors and the influence that's here and talks about the real fatigue that exists, I will say this, it is necessary for self-care. You have to put a fence around your time, particularly in this environment of Zoom and telecommunications and visuality that can just wear you down. So it's okay to say no, right, doctors? It's okay to say yes to what you can do and not feel bad about it. So I just wanted to give the framework that we're in a place again, you guys. We're back in a place again. We can ask what we need to ask. We can frame it. And we have an example now. Not what happened, not the past, but we have an example of what the future is going to look like. So... and then I will say for you, Traci, hey, I have a national conference. I have a national platform. We had over 2,000 attendees at our last conference. Why can't we have a right there at our conference, the Bigger Than Me platform where folks can come in, right? Start virtually. Why can't we ask our partners to shed a framework to have the Bigger Than Me conversations, right, Bill? When you were saying, let them come right on in. And let people that may want to go, where Cassandra can say, and Michelle, my corporate hat is over here, but I want to come in and just self-express where I'm at. And then you, and then small businesses like Loni, myself, and everyone else that are in the small business can connect. So I do have a platform. I have a national platform. I will say this to you, PBS selected us to do the diversity, equity, an inclusion documentary with Dennis Quaid that'll air in June. So the platform's getting ready to get bigger. So why not, right?
I agree. Right? And so that you guys know, this is the precursor to that, because all the work that we've been doing for the last 6 months, we're creating a documentary right now. Like the book is being written. The next thing that you guys will see from me, I'm working with, Albert and I both, experienced we're both internationally best-selling authors now. We just launched a book yesterday, our second book called Ignite Your Inner Spirit. And our first book was called Ignite Happiness. And that same author, you know, we're writing a book now. It's called Ignite Inclusion. Imagine that. You guys are all a part of it already. So I pitched this whole concept. I was like, hey, this is the work we've been doing. We got all the videos. So it's going to be a video documentary. It's going to be an audio book. It's going to be a video book. And you're all part of it. So we're going to be having you guys moving into this space. And those who are watching, you're going to hear much more about this. But I'm super excited. We are slightly over time. And I just wanted to end and just say, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. You all are amazing. I'm going to end now. We're going to probably let Bill share a few more things as we close. But for those who joined us, thank you. If you have to leave, thank you, thank you, thank you. We're just going to keep the recording going. So this is Traci, and we will edit this in like magic. It's going to be amazing. So from this session to what we did 6 months ago, all this stuff is going to be pulled together into an amazing book, and you guys will hear more from me about that. And you'll be able to contribute to edit kind of things you've said, to share and add in. It's amazing. So I'm super excited about this. This is our last session for 2020, but it is not the last time you're going to hear from me, because this work is about changing the status quo for generations to come, right? We're not having these conversations for the people that are listening to us now. We're having these conversations for our children's children. This is the content that will be out there for the rest of, we're leaving a legacy, and I'm super excited. So thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. I'm gonna give you guys a few minutes to drop. Anyone who's gonna drop, drop, and then we will continue to move forward. I'm gonna go directly to Bill Wells. If you wanna stay, please do stay, and I'll tell you how the conversation is gonna go. Bill Wells, I'm going to come to you. You said you had some things to share. There's some progress that you're aware of. I'm going to spotlight you.
Yep, I shared one in the chat, and I just mentioned that, and Pam's aware of it.
We're doing a video, so anything you put in the chat, I need you to actually say it. So because we'd actually do a video documentary as well. Yeah.
Well, I've got my notes. I'll go back through it. You just let me know when.
Right now, this is it.
Oh, okay. All right. In terms of commitments that have gone from conversation to action, there was announced this week, it was on CBS This Morning and maybe one other channel, but Ken Frazier, who's the CEO for Merck Pharmaceuticals, he led the conversation with another person. It's an initiative called 110, and 110 is about creating 1 million jobs specifically targeted at African Americans. And it's a collaboration of, I'm not sure how many different companies are involved. Pam may have a better handle on that. I think Pam said 38 companies, but it includes like Target, Merck, Delta Airlines, maybe JP Morgan Chase, big companies, major employers all across the country. So as I listened to Ken talk, this is not some affirmative action type of thing. What he addressed was the need for employers all around to come together to address the issues around racial inequities, social injustice, and wealth. And we know that wealth comes from, you got to have a job. I mean, you can't build wealth just thinking about it. So that's one thing that I wanted to bring to everybody's attention. You can look it up. It's called 110, and just one, the word, O-N-E, and then 10, T-E-N. Check it out, Google it, and it'll go right to it. There's another initiative, a really unique initiative that's in place, and it's Google has announced it. I don't know exactly when, but I started seeing ads on TV, and it's called Google, and it's called Training Near Me. And you just Google that. Google has created a platform, and partly it's selfish because they're looking for talent. And we've been talking about talent all day long through the session. But anyway, regardless of your age, your background, whatever, if you are interested in a career in the digital space, and it's focused on careers in the digital space, and you don't even have to do this to go to work for Google, but they're offering free training. And they're like 6 month certificates. You can go into programming. You can become an analyst. You can do project management. Anything that's included in this whole space of digital employment. And so that's one that I wanted to mention because, again, I just think that that's incredible. And what that directly addresses is oftentimes those folks who are not college educated per se, which is where a lot of low income and communities of color reside. And so they've opened up this fantastic platform for folks to go in and literally they will walk you through it. I know individuals that I shared that information with some younger folks who have been impacted by the pandemic. Their jobs are literally dead in the water. And they went on the website, you just Google, and it's Google Grow Me or something like that. They got right in. They did an online appointment scheduling and received a call, literally a call, within a day or so. So that's one thing that I wanted to mention to you. So that's kind of big news. That's about action. And we've been talking about action all day. So again, it's not so much what I'm doing as much as what I believe others can do. But I really believe that, you know, Traci, you pulled together a group of people that we've done this as a presentation or a town hall. You might want to consider just having like a think tank session. Okay. We got people with all different backgrounds, different sectors, what have you. We can come up with an action plan for ourselves and just figure out how to reach out past that.
So believe it or not, we actually do have one, but I kind of want to get, this is the laying of the groundwork. That's why I said you haven't heard the end of us yet. So we're going to bring that to this community. It's called the Bigger Than Me Success Series, but we have the Bigger Than Me Movement. We have Bigger Than Me Moments. We have a full change management. We have a number of things that we know we can do differently.
All right.
So you guys will be a part of that. That's kind of what, when I said we're going to bring this conversation forward, everything that you said and the voices and your faces, this is what should be out there in the universe right now. There's no reason why these are like these isolated little, you know, regional conversations. These are resources that should be out there and available. Like you said, you guys are amazing. And so we're going to make sure that the voices and the people who are willing to tell their story, get their story told. This is going to be a resource in every institution, academic institution. There's no reason why high school shouldn't understand this idea of race and equity, right? Hearing your voices. There's no reason why leaders, you know, it's there. So I promise you, you're going to love the next step. Okay. So does anyone else want to share? I'm just going to ask each person if there's any participant who wants to join, put your name in. I'm just going to call each person and then we're going to have you speak and then we're going to close, shut it down. So next person who has the video on is Rex Brown. Is there any final word that you would like to share as it relates to anything that we've talked about? Systems change, achieving racial equity and inclusion. You know what this initiative is all about. Is there anything else you'd like to share to put into the universe as a part of this video series, our book, and changing hearts and minds around the world?
I don't think there is. I think we've heard so much. It's probably worth revisiting the actual video once you have it available to actually review. But I will reiterate that the strongest possible tool that we have to make changes is to believe that we can do it. And that is usually the area that needs the most shoring up, because by the time we get to where we are, we no longer believe that we can change things. I know that that is not the case. And I'm really grateful again to be on this panel with you all today. And I'm looking forward to more work in the future.
So Rex, one thing I do want to ask you before you drop is, you mentioned in our past session, you talked about systems of inequity exist because people believe that they're unable to change them. And so you just said the one thing we need is to believe. And I love that, because again, this session was about resilience and radiance. We do have to believe, we do have to have confidence, we do have to have that positive energy to believe that we can drive change. And it is when other people like this group shows up that we can actually do it. Is there anything you want to share? Because this is the work you do for a living, is about changing systems. Is there any final words you want to share around changing systems?
Well, there is some research that actually points to belief as the key component of change. For changing systems, it's not, as Bill has alluded to in the chat box, it's not about the individual component only. The addressing and a lot of the work that we do, a lot of times we're solving the wrong problem. We're really addressing how the individual shows up in the workplace, as opposed to how we change and transform the actual workplace to a system that no longer perpetuates its beliefs that are ingrained within it, but has new beliefs that we together perpetuate. And that's a new intentional kind of thinking. It begins there. You know, I've also heard and agree with a lot of the panelists that it doesn't have to be as so complicated. Sometimes we overcomplicate things. It really, the process of belief is actually as simple as we have always known it to be. I think I can climb that mountain. I try to, and I get somewhere along the way. The more I believe, the higher I climb. And that's what we have to do with the really complex and large problem that we're faced with today.
Wow, I love it, I love it, I love it. Dr. Irene, I think you're gonna be our second to the last person to bring any final words. You have anything that you would like to share as we close?
I want to piggyback on what Rex just said about it all starts with belief. It is the, we always want to jump to strategies. We humans, we just want to like, what do we need to do? Like, let's just get doing it. But the thing is, if we don't have the belief that it's possible, that the belief in ourselves, that it's possible for us to make change, that it's, right? Because we always believe something's impossible until somebody does it. That was another Mandela quote that I just absolutely love. That, you know, whether it was breaking the 3-minute mile or going to the moon, it's like somebody always has to be that first one to believe that it can be done first. Because if you don't believe, then you put up huge blinders, blind spots to the capability and the solutions and strategies that are going to get you the results that you want. So thank you, Rex, that was beautiful. And I'm gonna leave with just one final quote from one of my heroes, who is Dr. Viktor Frankl, who survived 4 Holocaust death camps and was a neuropsychiatrist. And he said, despite everything that he endured, everything can be taken from a man but one thing, his ability to think and respond in any given situation. In other words, shit, I'm not supposed to, stuff is gonna happen. Life is going to happen. Adversity is going to happen. And it's up to us to choose how we're going to respond to it, whether we are going to be victimized by it and be, I'm a farmer, I'll say like the tail that wags the tail that gets wagged by the dog, or are we going to be the heroes of our story by saying, yes, you know what, this happened, it's going to happen, and I am going to use this to become the best version of me and to contribute to the world in the highest way possible. It all starts with us, each and every single one of us, and it all starts with belief.
Wow, I love that. I love that. And guess what? Guess what? I believe. I'm actually doing this work because I believe. And every time I get weary, every time I get, you know, feel any type of energy less than positive, optimism, someone new comes into my life and comes into my space, some divine connection happens. And I'm like, oh, thank you so much, right? And I'm glad the last person that's on this call, I'm glad it's you, Lennox, because you were that person for me. Like, you came on, and honestly, you came into my life, and I was like, wow, what a blessing, what a divine connection. You know, I'm grateful for you. So I'm just gonna, I could go on and on and on, but you've offered some funding to help us to take all these amazing videos and turn them into the tangible output that really will be able to change the world. You know, she has PBS who's gonna be funding her for a documentary. Well, we got the documentary, right? here. Like, we've been doing this work for 6 months. You experience one session and you're like, wow, that's some great content. We have some amazing content. In addition to the group sessions, we have one-on-one, hours and hours of one-on-one dialogue with these amazing people. So we have what we need now. We're just going to be pulling that together in a way that will allow us to produce a tangible asset for the universe. So I just wanted to say thank you, because you did show up with this level of radiance, which is why I called it resilience and radiance, having courageous conversations. I just ended my call with you saying thank you, Lord, for that divine connection, for bringing someone in who actually has a heart to serve, who wants to live their life as a contribution. So thank you for saying the words, but for also acting and doing it. So any final words that you would share in general?
Yeah, there sure is. I appreciate that Bill brought up the 110 project. It really is showing that corporate America is stepping in right now to make a difference in today. And there's also other projects to help make a major impact down the road. I was introduced to the Institute for Urban Education at the University of Missouri. And that's where I was able to share the information. There was other research done that if a Black student has two or more Black teachers, it's a 32% greater chance that they will go to college. And education, that core education to open up opportunities for Black Americans is very valuable for more Black Americans to have opportunity. And the Institute for Urban Education has 50 Black Americans in process getting scholarships to get their teacher certificates, and they all have jobs coming out of there. The school districts want more Black American teachers. And so, therefore, I believe in this as a core item. I like those percentages, 32% increase. And next year is our 90th year at John O. Scott Real Estate. And for our 90th year project, we're committing to sponsoring several Black Americans to get their teacher certificate, because we know that can impact thousands of students and open up greater opportunity, greater inclusion, and greater equity down the road.
I love that. So Lennox, the one thing I did want to share with you is, you know, first of all, I'm just grateful for you, but the, you know, the fact that you've been doing this work and you've been committed to doing it, you're looking at systemic change. I just hope that's not being overlooked. So I just want to make sure that I'm going to continue to elevate and share the great work that you're doing, because it's like, I don't know, you really are a success story. So thank you for that. And part of what we're doing, just for the audience, I want to see if I can spotlight everyone who is left in this gallery view. So what I really wanted to do is share that this work, all these videos, these conversations are actually going to be pulling together. I'm just going to spotlight myself. I'm going to spotlight you, and I'm going to spotlight beautiful Dr. Irene. There you go. So we're actually pulling together this video content that is basically training. So youth are going to now see Black faces, white faces, diverse faces, talking to them and educating them on topics that we don't talk about. So if you think about education, I love the idea of the real estate licenses. I love the idea of helping teachers to get their license and getting two teachers to do that. I want you to know that we're going to literally lean in and create 90 faces, right? 100, you know, faces of individuals who will be going into schools through this online space and teaching them about life in general, right? Talking about equity, talking about inclusion, talking about what it looks like, because part of the problem that Dr. Irene mentioned, those rats, right? Like, things happen and we don't talk about the trauma that we experience. So all the thing that happens to our youth is that they have these visceral reactions, but they don't have any training, any education. No one talks about it. So that's the other thing that this work is going to do, so that you know how you're helping us, is you've already helped to give me greater hope that we're going to truly be able to change the status quo in a number of different ways. So I just wanted to say thank you. I'm excited. I hope you get even more excited about what you're doing in the 90th. So inadvertently, you're getting two teachers, their teacher certificate, but you're getting 90 teachers. Think about a university, but a community. We're building a community that will be in our schools, all of our schools, right? This information will be free and online and in YouTube, and we're going to get to the social media, and it's going to be available. So just know that you're also creating teachers in a different way. You're bringing these faces, these Black faces, these white faces, these all of these diverse faces together to really teach and train on the idea of equity and inclusion, right? You help kids to believe that they deserve better, right? That you can do better, that this is what better, this is what success looks like. Oh, this is what happens when you have a challenge. So that's what these lessons are about. So we are also training, right? Not necessarily teacher certificates, but I can tell you it's about this bigger than me movement that is truly going to change the status quo. So thank you for everything. I appreciate you all. This is our official close. And again, you'll hear more from us through email about our next opportunity as we bring these amazing videos forward. Thank you.